to promote good sportsmanship by student athletes, coaches, and spectators. We request your cooperation by supporting the participants and umpires in a positive manner. Now let's meet today's starting lineup. First, for the visiting Villanova Wildcats. Leading off, center fielder, number 8, Chris Rotondo. At third base, 44, Nick LaRusso. At first base, 21, Ryan Tours. The cleanup batter is the right fielder, 36, Jack O'Reilly. Number 22 is the second baseman, Cameron Hassard. At shortstop, 13, Dylan McNary. Number 9 is the designated hitter, Jeff Manto. In left field, number 1, A.J. Hansen. And batting ninth, starting behind the plate, number 4, Will Reiner. Starting pitcher for the Wildcats is number 31, Tyler Arella. And the head coach of the Wildcats is Kevin Mulvey. And now, the starting lineup for your Butler Bulldogs. Leading off, the left fielder, number 6, James Gargano. Batting second, the designated hitter, 23, Colin All. 41 starts at first base, Dan Harwood. Batting cleanup, starting behind the plate, number 9, Duncan Hewitt. The third baseman, number 7, Freddie Matos. Number 2 is the second baseman, Brody McGrath. In right field, number 10, Matt McElwain. Starting at shortstop, number 16, A.J. Pointer. And batting ninth, center fielder, 39, John Shoup. Taking the ball for the Bulldogs, number 11, John McCauley. Butler assistant coaches, Bailey Montgomery, Matt Kennedy, and Ben Norton. And the head coach of your Bulldogs is Dave Schrag. Now, fans, please help me welcome our umpires for today's game. TJ Cunningham, Bob Howard, and Daniel Jimenez. And now, fans, at this time, we ask that you please rise and remove your hats for the playing of our national anthem.
Good afternoon, Bulldog fans. We are coming to you live from the Bulldog Park on the campus of Butler University for Butler baseball. The Bulldogs are taking on Villanova in the rubber match of this three-game set. Alongside Chuck Levine, I am Anthony Cleva, and it's a beautiful Sunday afternoon for baseball in Indianapolis.
It is perfect weather today, Anthony.
Yes, Butler coming off an 8-1 loss to the Wildcats yesterday in Game 2 of the series, but they did win Game 1 by a score of 10-5. Butler's looking to get their first Big East series win this season. So, Chuck, tell me, what does Butler need to do to get that win today and that's to clinch this series?
Yeah, Butler is really looking to get going here again after last game, putting up just one run, not very many hits. Anyone they had two players with streaks. Mr. Matos had his 9-game on base streak halted as of yesterday, and Dan Harwood as well had a 4-game hit streak coming into the game. So a lot of just looking to get going again. They have guys that can get on base. Dan Harwood leading the team in average, hitting 340, on base 397. Freddie Matos also hitting 310, leads the team in on base percentage of 423. And Brody McGrath, has also been hitting very well. Unfortunately, today they don't have many run producers in their lineup. Aaron Steinhardt, who is tied with Robbie McCarger for the team lead in home runs with four, both out of the lineup, and Steinhardt also leading the team in RBIs with 19. Andy Bennett, another name, has 11 RBIs to his name as well. So a lot of the guys that are producing for this team are not in the lineup, at least to get us going today. And then the pitcher, John McCauley, obviously a team full of pitchers that are having a little bit of struggles early. He has a winning record at 2-1. He's fourth in strikeouts with 25. Mostly, we got to get to the guy in the back of the bullpen who has five single inning appearances, Scott Wright. 1.88 ERA, so he can put him away strong at the end.
Yes, there you have it there. Butler winning the previous three series against Villanova, looking to extend that to four straight against the Wildcats, as first pitch swung on, fouled off by Chris Rotondo, playing center field for Villanova today. First pitch at 12:04, and it is a beautiful 52 today, a little bit of breeze.
Yeah, it's been sunny since I got out of bed this morning. Beautiful day for baseball.
McCauley working fast on 1-1, swung on and missed, or fouled off by Rotondo.
Both teams struggling in conference coming into this game. Obviously, Butler's non-conference record at 3-7 and a total record of 8-16 leave something to be desired by Bulldog fans, but putting them away and maintaining the streak, like you said, of 4 years, beating Villanova, makes a lot of Bulldog fans happy.
Yes, as the 1-2 was fouled off again by Rotondo. John McCauley is a junior from Paducah, Kentucky. Went to St. Mary High School. As the 1-2 gets Rotondo looking for out number one in the top of the first here.
Bringing up to the plate for the Wildcats, the third baseman, 44, Nick LaRusso.
It was a pretty efficient pitching there by McCauley.
Yeah, got him to 1-2 pretty quick. Had a little bit of struggle finishing him off there, but put him away with a nice K.
Nick LaRusso, the third baseman for Villanova, takes the box. And first pitch is strike one, high and inside.
You really love to see pitchers hitting that strike zone early, pounding the zone. We'll see if they can maintain that throughout the game.
McCauley, every time he gets the ball, is ready to pitch. That's another strike there, moving the count 0-2 and getting ahead of Nick LaRusso.
Yeah, with the second game of the doubleheader canceled yesterday, both teams had, you know, a bit of lineup mixing to do. So a little bit of short notice for John McCauley, but he is looking pretty strong to start us off.
LaRusso batting 237 on the season as the 1-2 swung on and hit to the third baseman. Thrown to first, but the ball goes wide, but Hewitt there to back up the ball. It's going to keep LaRusso at first base.
Yeah, it was going to be a tight play either way. Ball ended up bouncing past. But like you said, fantastic defense by the catcher to back up first baseman there.
Looks like they're going to give LaRusso a hit there because of his speed.
Yeah, I think he probably would have been safe anyway, but it would have been pretty close.
Yes, with one on and one out here on the top of the first, Ryan Torres, the first baseman for Villanova, now batting. McCauley, first pitch strike, catching that inside part of the plate. Looking to get a ground ball here.
Pitcher's best friend. Double play ball.
McCauley gets Tour swinging.
You know, in a lot of cases, I think we'll take a strikeout just as well as we'll take a double play here.
Yes, always immobilizing the big part of the order here is a good chance to get a good start. And there's the ground ball. Torres to the second base. McGrath tags it and throws to the first baseman, Hardwood, and that is the double play that John McCauley was looking for.
Absolutely perfect. Drew it up just right.
Bulldogs coming to the plate.
Able to field.
Back here at Bulldog Park for the bottom of the first inning, Butler versus Villanova, 0-0 after the top of the first. Leading off for the Bulldogs is the left fielder, James Gargano.
Now we're going to see if Butler can get that momentum carried over from defense to offense. Obviously finishing off the inning, great double play, gets you going, gets you hyped. Great play early and the strikeout as well, so all things you love to see.
Working for Villanova today is the southpaw, Tyler Arella. Arella, senior from East Northport, New York. The second pitch of the at-bat's fouled off, and Arella working ahead of Gargano, 0-2.
Big cuts here early. I think we'll probably see a shortened up swing, maybe. Choke up a little bit.
Yes. Arella, the 0-2. Gets Gargano looking. Caught the inside corner of that plate right there.
The designated hitter, 23.
And both leadoff batters are going to go down looking today.
All in all, the designated hitter looking good, grew the flow out, having fun playing baseball.
That's all is DHing today, batting 200. He's only played in 6 games this year, playing in his 7th now. Bulldog looking to shake something up today with bringing All and Hewitt in the lineup. Struggling a little bit with a 8-16 record. They are 3-7 in the Big East.
Yeah, Colin All is the kind of guy, he came in a little heavier freshman year, and he has really worked to improve his body, get in baseball shape, which, you know, some people may joke about, but this kid has put in a lot of work to get his body and his game where he wants it, and always looking to improve.
The count moves to 2-1, and Arella winds and deals. Swung on, hit to the shortstop. Over to the first baseman, Torres, for out number 2.
41.
First two quick outs for Butler.
Harwood.
We were hoping we could see get a couple hits in early, work off the momentum of the defense, but not to be so far.
Batting third for the Bulldogs today is the first baseman, Dan Harwood. Having a .340 batting average, leading the team. As the first pitch from Arroyo is fouled off. And that curveball is going to miss high and inside, almost hit Harwood, the senior from Brecksville, Ohio. And the 1-1 is going to be a strike. Harwood thought it was a little high, but the umpire gets final say. Both Arella and McCauley working pretty quick on the mound.
Yeah, both pitchers not afraid to put the ball in the zone.
Dan Arroyo wanted that when he started walking off the mound there.
Yeah, lots of reactions from the Butler dugout.
Count 2-2, two outs here. Bottom first. And Arroyo's going to get Harwood looking.
For the Bulldogs in the bottom of the first.
Yeah, he wanted that last one and just missed, so we put it right where. Couldn't say no. Right on the outside edge there.
Tyler Arroyo goes 1-2-3, getting two strikeouts in the bottom of the first. You're watching Butler Baseball on Butler Athletics YouTube Live. We are back here for the second inning at Bulldog Park. Butler taking on Villanova in the third game of this three-game series. Looking to get a win today and take the series. Leading off for Villanova is the right fielder, Jack O'Reilly.
Yeah, Butler has not lost a series to Villanova, I believe, at home since 2018. And that is the only time that they've lost the home series.
First pitch, swung on and hit out to right field. McElwain under it for out number one.
Quick outs to start both innings.
Second baseman, 22, Cameron Hassert.
It's the first pitch outs are what pitchers all dream of.
Yeah, quick outs. Hey, man, immaculate innings, three-pitch innings. Don't happen very often, but fly outs, ground outs, those will get you.
And the first pitch to Villanova second baseman Cameron Hassert is ball one.
Hassert, one of the three freshmen on this Villanova Wildcats team. And unfortunately, not many of them hitting very well. AJ Hansen, 227 is the highest. O'Reilly at 217, who just flew out, obviously. And coming into the game, Hassert batting 118. So lots of players looking to get going early.
First three pitches of this bat have missed the strike zone. The 3-0. And it's going to miss, and that's going to be another Villanova base runner. Four straight balls from John McCauley.
13, the shortstop, Dylan McNary.
Yeah, you know, you can only really get a guy to chase if he swings at something close first or doesn't swing. try to get him to reach.
With one on and one out in the top of the second, the shortstop Dylan McNary now hitting for the Wildcats.
That walk, McCauley's 17th issued so far this season. He's pitched just 22 innings, which it's strange. They have most of their pitchers are around the 20, 21, 22 inning mark, and then we have two with 39 and 40. Connor Schultz at 39.
This is the 1-0 was swung on and missed by McNary. The 1-1 missed outside. McCauley needs to keep an eye on Hassard at first base. He has stolen three times this year in all three of his attempts.
Yeah. Good to make sure that he's staying close, but it's also right 2-1 after four straight balls. You really need to work on getting the ball back in the strike zone here.
Deep breath from McCauley. It fires. 2-1, and that's fouled off down the right field line and heading off the tennis bubble.
I imagine there will be a lot of those today. Must be weird if you're inside the bubble and then just hear foul balls coming down. A little fireworks or something.
McCauley looking for another ground ball here to get his second double play of the game. As McCauley does keep an eye on Hassert at first base.
Hassert not taking a huge lead, but
the 2-2 curveball misses low and outside. Trying to get McNary to swing and miss there.
Full count now, we'll see. I'd be looking for him, of course, keeping it low. So if he does swing, it'll be a ground ball, but maybe just trying to get him looking.
But before the 3-2 pitch, McCauley is going to check Hassard again. Keeping him honest there. Villanova might have a hit and run here with a full count. And only one out.
Certainly, yeah, with one out, they'll be looking to get runners in scoring position as early as possible.
McCauley's pitch swung on and hit out to left field. Gargano under it and makes the catch, route number two.
Sound that made off the bat, I was beginning to think he might not have needed to start stealing, but
Jeff Manto
able to get under it in left field. That was James Gargano.
Two outs here. McCauley working with one on. And Jeff Manto, the DH for Villanova, is stepping up to the plate. Hey, Jeff. As the 0-0 to Manto misses high and inside. Manto really didn't flinch there, so he might have been looking to take one for the team and get a runner into scoring position here early in the game.
Yeah, both teams this season have struggled. Well, Villanova has struggled more than Butler has with run production, but obviously Butler coming off a game where they only were able to scratch across one run, so I think both teams will be aggressive when it comes to getting runners in scoring position, like you said.
This is the 1-0 to Manto, swung on, fouled way back behind the tennis bubble. McCauley and Hassard goes. The throw from Hewitt.
Throw was well-timed. Might have beat him, but just short, bounced, skipped in, and over the glove of the second baseman.
The pitch was a strike, though, moving the count to 1-2. McCauley looking to get the batter and really doesn't care about Hassard with two outs.
Just got to focus on putting away the guy at the plate.
McCauley making sure Hassard goes back and doesn't get a good lead here, just in case Manto hits one to the outfield.
Yeah, with two outs and two strikes, you really want to see a pitcher focus on the guy at the plate, but Hassard obviously can.
The 1-2 curveball swung on, hit to the second baseman. McGrath over to Harwood for out number three, and that's going to do it.
For Villanova in the top of the second, no runs, no hits.
Villanova's going to strand another.
Fans, friendly reminder from Butler
here.
Athletics. Please remain alert of your surroundings.
In the top of the second inning, they've so far left two guys on base, but McCauley working efficiently here.
Yeah, McCauley keeping it close for sure, keeping his team in there. Offense just got to get it going.
On the ground floor of the press box.
That's going to do it for the top of the second inning. You're watching Butler Baseball and Butler Athletics YouTube Live. Here for the bottom of the second, Butler taking on Villanova.
The catcher, number nine.
Leading off for the Bulldogs is the catcher, Duncan Hewitt. He'll be followed by Freddie Matos and Brody McGrath.
His batting average has actually increased drastically when he bats leadoff, batting 333, likely due to just not a lot of situations, but with the average currently at 103, or looking for him to get started early.
As the first pitch is swung on and hit out to the left fielder, and the left fielder dives and misses and unable to make the catch. As Hewitt is going to get a double. He thought about going three, but decided that he would take the leadoff double to give Butler a good scoring chance here.
Yeah, the big man starting us off strong.
Brings to the plate the third.
Bats well when he bats leadoff, proving it there.
It's the left fielder, A.J. Hansen, unable to make that diving catch.
Now Matos, the senior, coming to bat, batting 310, a guy who's been able to put the ball in play all the time and reach base in nine consecutive games leading up to yesterday.
Butler has been presented here with an early scoring opportunity to take the lead.
This is a big chance for the Dogs.
Is a lefty versus lefty action. Usually the pitcher has the upper hand in this lineup, but the first pitch by Matos hit to the center fielder as Hewitt looks to tag up, but will stay at second.
Second baseman.
Yeah, great throw from the outfield, kept him at second base. I don't know if he ever was really going to go, more of just testing him out.
Make him draw a throw.
Yeah, see what the arm can do. Test it out for guys who maybe would go on a shorter contact like that.
Well, these Butler bats are being aggressive. That's back-to-back two first pitch swinging.
Brody McGrath.
Zarhella. First pitch misses low. Hewitt at second base here with one out in the bottom of the second. I'm ready. Arella winds and misses high.
This is going to be a challenge pitch here. 2-0 count. Free swinging at bat for Brody McGrath.
Brody McGrath is a senior from Albany, Ohio. There are six seniors batting today for the Bulldogs. A very veteran lineup. As the 2-0 is swung on and hit high. And that's going to foul off the Butler hitting facility. out in the field.
Our indoor hitting facility. A nice barn in our outfield. Every stadium has its own special things.
Yes.
I'm from California. Back in Oakland, the A's have massive space in foul territory because of using that stadium for football as well. So it's the little things that just make every stadium a little bit different.
Yes, and with Butler in left field, we have the indoor hitting facility, and on the right field side, we have a big tennis bubble.
Yeah, not going to see one of those every day.
As the 2-1 is a strike.
There's some things you can only get here on the campus of Butler University. From a 2-0 to a 2-2.
Arella worked all the way back. The 2-2 swung on and hit to the second baseman. But the speed of McGrath is going to beat that one out for a single.
Excellent hustle all around. Their second baseman looked like he was going to set up something great. Cameron Hassert, the freshman, just unable to get the throw over to him on time. And the ball popped out anyway, so first and third with one out, huge chance for Butler.
And that's going to bring up Matt McElwain. And as Chuck was saying, Duncan Hewitt did advance to third base. With Butler with runners on first and third here with one out, big opportunity here.
Just six hits in his first 22 at-bats. Looking to increase that RBI total.
The first pitch from Arella hits the inside corner.
And the most important part of him beating it out at first there, now a deep fly ball like we've had already in this inning could score a run. Don't even need a hit.
It's the 0-1 is fouled off into the Butler dugout. McElwain is down here. Looking to create anything to get Hewitt across home plate.
Batting 500 with runners in scoring position. Never hurts to have a number like that.
Arella. 0-2 misses. Outside.
Great job waiting for his pitch. Not chasing anything too far out of the zone, especially here with two strikes, staying defensive, staying within the zone.
Arella really doesn't have to worry about Butler stealing bases today, or as McGrath does go, though. He's going to get him out. As I was saying, Butler's current lineup, only has 7 stolen bases this year. But then McGrath is going to get tagged out.
Yeah, McGrath took off there. The throw clearly beat him. Tried to slide to the outside, maybe avoid the tag, but it was unsuccessful. And usually in that situation, that runner at first is maybe used more as a decoy to get the runner from third to home. Seen that quite often in the MLB, having someone, you know, get caught in a pickle just to create the focus over there so that the runner from third can sneak home. Not to be on that play, though.
As the count is 2-2 with 2 outs, as McGrath did get thrown out at second base. Swung on, hit to the shortstop. And their first baseman's unable to make the scoop, and that's going to score. It's going to score Duncan Hewitt for the first run of the game.
Yeah, shortstop Dylan McNary trying to make it look easy out there. It was a very slick throw, but low and in the dirt, popped out of the glove. Butler scores.
Yes, Ryan Tours unable to make that play at first base. And they're going to give an error to the shortstop, McNary, on the low throw.
Yeah, that throw in the dirt, first baseman never really had a chance.
As the first pitch by A.J. Pointer is swung on and fouled off.
Yeah, let's see if Butler can add on to this early scoring.
Butler taking this early lead, 1-0 in the bottom of the second, 2 outs. McIlwain is at first. And the 0-1 is going to be right down the middle for AJ Pointer. The 0-2 from Arella. Inside. To me, that looked like it hit the jersey of AJ Pointer.
But. Yeah, hard to tell. It looked like he was certainly leaning out over the plate, trying to create something, and turn to look back at the umpire, maybe trying to suggest he say that it hit him. But
as the 1-2 swung out, and it looks like it's going to fall down in between the shortstop and center fielder in no man's land. And that's going to be a hit from the shortstop, AJ Pointer.
Two out, the center fielder.
Well, they're looking to hang a crooked number here.
John, shoot.
John Shoup, the freshman, comes to the plate with the voice of Snoop Dogg and Pharrell Williams.
Arella back on the mound. Two outs here, bottom second. Butler leading 1-0. As the first pitch to Shoup is strike one. Butler has runners on first and second. McIlwain is at second with Pointer at first. As the 0-1 to Shoup, curveball misses outside.
Butler doing a great job here early of staying inside themselves on 0-2 and 0-1 counts, not giving the pitcher any favors, doing any favors, excuse me.
Arella winds and deals, and that one swung on. Out to center field, and it's going to be caught on the run by Chris Rotondo in center field to end the inning. But Butler scoring one, capitalizing on the error from shortstop McNary.
Yeah, Butler hustling all the way through the inning, beginning to end.
Villanova, zero.
Ends up with that.
Top of the third inning at Bulldog Park. Butler taking on Villanova. And the Bulldogs are leading the Wildcats 1-0 here after a run in the bottom of the second.
Number one, A.J. Hansen.
And leading off for Villanova for the first time today is the left fielder, A.J. Hansen. What have you liked so far in John McCauley on the mound?
He's been throwing a lot of strikes, not afraid to put it in the zone. Sorry, we got a catcher, something in his eye maybe, delaying the start of this inning. But yeah, we have a guy who's on the mound, maybe sort of a late replacement because of having to mix everything around. But you know, he's keeping balls in the strike zone, not afraid to challenge hitters, hasn't given up any big hits yet, so keeping the ball down, keeping it, in the field of play, creating pop-ups, so forcing guys to get both on top and under the ball.
As Dave Schrag, head coach of Butler, and his staff go to check on Hewitt behind the plate, and looks like he's ready to go. Might have had something in his eye.
Yeah, maybe a contact fell out or something.
And now A.J. Hansen will step into the box and start inning three here. McCauley's ready even before Hansen steps in the box. As he winds and deals. And the first pitch misses high.
Yeah, talking about the things that I've liked seeing from him, the things we need him to improve on to keep up the pace for this win is keep balls in the strike zone. He's had some struggles starting counts off, getting in hitters counts, and really not helping himself out, but so far been able to maintain his composure here.
As the 2-0 hits the outside corner for strike number one. And wheeling and dealing again is John McCauley as that pitch is fouled off. And he is now back into leading in the count, 2-2.
Well, pretty even if it's 2-2. But
yeah, but here's the thing. If the pitcher gets one more strike,
That's true.
The at-bat's over and the 2-2.
Speaking of, that looked like a very nice pitch. Yes.
Curveball missed a little bit high there.
Want to keep that one low, but at the same time could definitely freeze somebody.
As the full count swung on and hit out to left field. And A.J. Hansen's going to start off the inning with a single.
The catcher, number 4, Will Reiner.
McCauley really wanted to get Hansen on that curveball, and it seemed like this 3-2 pitch was a fastball, but the fastball that hung out over the plate for A.J. Hansen to poke out to left field.
It looked pretty clear as well that A.J. Hansen was, you know, sitting fastball in that situation, just got that breaking pitch.
As Reiner squares around to bunt. And the third baseman, Matos, throws it over to first base for out number one, advancing A.J. Hansen to second base.
Number 8, center fielder, Chris Rotondo.
And that's going to bring the top of the order for the Wildcats up. And Chris Rotondo batting for the second time today with a runner in scoring position. In his first plate appearance, he was called out on strikes looking. Hey, Rotondo! McCauley once again working on the mound with a runner on base.
Especially with one out, he's looking back at him quite often. Umpire giving time called there. McCauley was taking a long time to deliver that pitch, looking back at the runner at second base.
Yes, A.J. Hansen does have some speed on him, has stolen 4 bases this year on 4 attempts.
Especially with a batter, a right-handed batter blocking the view of the catcher there. If a lefty's at bat right, stealing third is a lot harder because that catcher has an open window right to third base. But here, you got a guy who's got to get out of the way, who might be purposefully a little slow.
As the first official pitch of that bat was a ball. And the 1-0 is looked on by Rotondo and called strike. With runners on scoring position today, Villanova is 0-3. McCauley looking to keep that the situation.
Yeah, Rotondo, a .391 batting average with runners in scoring position. So a guy who has come through a lot for Villanova, even though they've struggled putting up runs.
And McCauley forces Hansen to go back with the little jump fake.
It would seem our runner at second base is definitely occupying some mental real estate.
As the 1-1 does catch that outside corner. Moving the count to 1-2 on Rotondo.
Switching up signs with the second baseman now with the runner on second.
McCauley's 1-2, fouled off.
Yeah. Yeah, when no runners are on and a pitcher's not really worried about anyone, often they can get in a rhythm and then batters can get used to that rhythm. With a guy on, it can throw it off for the batter too when a pitcher takes so long to deliver down the home plate.
One and two, McCauley delivers. Ooh, curveball misses, wanted a Rotondo chasing, but he was able to hold off there.
Yeah, actually great placement, obviously out of the strike zone, but that was the intention, get him to swing at something in the dirt. Both teams not chasing early.
And that's going to be a wild pitch on McCauley, and A.J. Hansen's going to be able to advance to third base.
You know what, in the situation of John McCauley, that might even, having that runner move to third might actually be better. He doesn't have to worry about him stealing now. He can just worry about the batter right in front of him. He's already got two strikes. Let's focus up and finish this inning off strong.
As you said, McCauley moved back to the windup, but that 3-2 is going to miss outside.
44, third baseman.
He's now going to have two base runners to deal with now, with one out here.
Yep, tried to get him to chase once again and not working out for him.
And Nick LaRusso is going to step in for the second time today. He did hit a ground ball in between the second and the shortstop and the third baseman, but was able to beat it out here. Maybe another ground ball here to roll a double play and end the inning. Is what John McCauley's looking for. As the first pitch is strike one.
Absolutely, with one out and runners on the corners, similar to what Butler had, we just really got to make sure to put the inning away as quickly as possible.
McCauley's curveball, unable to catch it, is Duncan Hewitt behind the plate, and that allows Rotondo to advance to second, so that's going to take the double play out of question here.
Yep. McCauley has put a lot of the weight back on his own shoulders just by a few throwing errors.
Let's go, boys! No jacking, let's go!
And the 0-2 pitch. It's gonna low there, but looked pretty good from up here.
Yeah, that looked mighty fine from where we're sitting.
McCauley working with some runners on base now, with one out here on the top of the third. The 1-2, curveball swung on and hit out to center field. Shoop camping under it, catches and throws home. It's going to be a play at the plate.
Able to get the...
But Hansen able to beat out the throw from the center fielder, Shoop.
Yeah, just a little behind the runner as well as a bit up the line. Unable to make the play at the plate. And the runner from second able to advance to third on the play as well. Looked like there might have been a chance to get him, but our third baseman was just not ready. So
that's going to bring up the first baseman, Ryan Tours, with two out here. And it looks like Butler's intentionally walking Ryan Tours.
Set up a force play.
Set up the force play and maybe immobilize their best hitter.
That as well. Take their best hitter out of run scoring opportunity. That is exactly what the intentional walk was made for.
That's going to bring up the right fielder, Jack O'Reilly. He flew out to right field in his first plate appearance.
We'll take that here as a flyout would end the inning.
As the 0-1 curveball misses. McCauley's using that curveball a lot today here, trying to get hitters swing in and off balance.
Yeah, McCauley attempting to get hitters swinging and missing out of the zone. Not much success early. It's when he's powering balls over the plate that's where he's been successful.
And that one's going to catch the outside corner
Pain
of the plate.
Corners.
Moving the count 1-1. Villanova has two runners on with two outs here. Rotondo on third and Torres on first. O'Reilly in the box and McCauley winds. And that's another curveball that misses outside.
And Hassert already with a stolen base on deck.
Two and one, misses outside, moving the count to 3-1. Colley needs to take a deep breath here and come right at the hitters.
Yep, you got it. You got to expect a challenge pitch here from McCauley.
Three-one. McCauley goes, tries to get Torres at first. Throw a little late. It was a good attempt though. Keep Torres honest over at first base.
Yeah, first baseman Dan Harwood also checking the runner back to third base.
McCauley goes at Torres again and thought he had him.
McCauley really thought he had him, and he was getting a lot of hype from the dugout as well. Whole team very audible in the dugout.
Looks like
thinking they got the runner at first.
Torres is going to shorten his lead at first. As McCauley goes towards the plate, moves the count full. Torres will be moving at first base here on the pitch.
McCauley very emotional after that pickoff attempt. Jumping on the mound.
Yes, really thought he had a pickoff here.
Gotta remind himself to calm down and get back in the zone.
3-2, Torres goes, and that's gonna miss for ball four. It's gonna load the bases.
22, second baseman,
first baseman
Hassard.
Dan Harwood goes and tries to settle McCauley down a little bit.
Hassard, who reached on a walk last time, and McCauley already shaky. We know Hassard isn't going to do him any favors.
McCauley looking to strand here. Three runners in the top of the third. The score is 1-1. This first pitch is going to be a called strike.
Yeah, with two outs, Butler has a lot of options on how they can get out of this. Just got to make sure he puts pitches over the plate and in the zone.
And McCauley working ahead of Cameron Hassard, 0-2.
See if he can finish him off here.
Looks like McCauley is definitely,
prevent the big inning.
Yes, McCauley definitely comfortable in the windup. Here with bases loaded, more so when he has to throw from the stretch.
Certainly.
That's gonna be ball one on Cameron Hassert.
That pitch missing, you hope he brings it back down. That one, I guess, just a bit low.
This looked a little low and outside, but a good pitch to try to get.
Certainly a good spot.
Yes, try to get Hassert swinging there. Count 2-2, two outs here. And that pitch is swung on. Head out to the center fielder, John Shoup, camping under it, and he's going to be able to make the catch and end the inning.
Well, I don't know how they did it, but they only gave up one run in that whole situation. Able to strand those three. Excellent job by the Dogs to get out of it. Now let's go get some insurance in the bottom half.
Yes, Villanova did get that one run back in the first, but it could have been a whole lot worse for the Bulldogs, but John McCauley able to come back and get some outs to strand three, and that's going to do it for the top of the third. You're watching Butler Baseball on Butler Athletics YouTube Live. welcome back here for the bottom of the third inning at Bulldog Park. Butler taking on Villanova. Score is tied one apiece here. Chuck, what have you seen so far that Butler needs to keep working on to try to get a win here?
Well, offensively, right, we just need to keep stringing hits together. That was why we were successful in the second inning. We were able to scratch across that run, stringing across hits early, and you know, just being productive with our outs, moving runners, sack flies.
As the first pitch to James Gargano is called a strike from Tyler Arella.
And Gargano swinging early in his first at bat. Already took the first pitch.
Gargano was eventually called out on strikes in his first plate appearance and now finds himself down in the count 0-2. There's the 0-2 from Arella. Swung on. Hit to the third baseman, LaRusso. Over towards that first base for out number one.
23, the designated hitter, Colin Hall.
Good to see Gargano putting swings on it rather than just watching it go by this time. Maybe next time he can inch out a hit. Steady progress.
Sin with one out here in the bottom of the third. That's going to bring up the DH, Colin Hall. Tyler Arella on the mound for the Wildcats. He winds up and pitches, and pitch one is going to be ball one.
I got to say, the big difference in our two pitchers so far, both giving up one run, mostly it's been the defense. Obviously, John McCauley having a rough day, missing a lot over the plate. Lots of walks so far. And on the other side, Tyler Arella pitching pretty well on the mound. Unfortunately, lots of errors in his defense. A missed catch in the outfield is how Butler got their runner on second, as well as multiple errors in the infield. We're able to get that runner around to eventually score.
As the 1-1 pitch from Arella misses low, moving the count to 2-1 on Colin Hall.
Looking for a big swing from the designated hitter. We'll wait till we can get one in the zone.
Yes, that one's going to miss high end outside on all. Great hitter's count here. Good opportunity for all to maybe see a pitch that he likes and swing at it. But the home plate umpire is going to call that pitch a strike.
Colin Hall very sure that one was not in the zone, well on his way down to first base.
Yes, halfway down to first base, but he has to retreat and face a 3-2.
Can be hard to get right back in the mindset there. Might have relaxed right when he thought ball four. That one's certainly ball four.
Yes, that one's going to be ball four.
First baseman, 41, Dan Harwood.
Colin Hall seemed to know that he was going to get walked. That's why he wanted to go a pitch earlier.
Yeah, maybe he can just, you know, he can read the future.
With one out, that's going to put Colin Hall on first base with Dan Harwood, Butler's best hitter up there.
Yeah, Dan Harwood also leading the team in slugging percentage at .604. 16 RBIs on the year.
As the first pitch to Harwood is head out to the right fielder.
Absolute bullet by the first baseman, but right into the glove.
That's the line drive from Harwood, caught by the right fielder, Jack O'Reilly. And that's going to be out number two.
Yeah, that often the most frustrating situation as a batter. You made great contact, you're ready to go, and the runner on first is, you know, ready to hustle on over, but when it just lines into the glove there, stays up a little too long.
And catcher Duncan Hewitt steps back in the box. He did double in his first plate appearance and later came around to score for Butler's first run of the game.
Seems to be a tale of situational hitting for Duncan Hewitt. Batting obviously now 125 after the double brought it up from 103. But with leading off, right, he was batting 333, and with two outs, he's down at 200. With especially 077 with runners on.
And all the goes
DH
to second.
Goes.
And he's going to be safe. Looks like the throw tailed off a little bit, and Colin Aull was able to slide in safely at second base.
Don't often see a DH take off, especially knowing with his background as a catcher.
Yes, and that's Colin Aull's first attempt this year and first stolen base.
All right, keep the record perfect.
It's a big opportunity here for Duncan Hewitt now. Looking to bring all in as the 2-1 swung on. A couple big hacks here from the catcher.
Yeah, one homer on the year so far, 17 strikeouts, just three RBIs. But he's already had a double today. Maybe he can continue to turn it around.
Tyler Arella winds on the 2-2. That one's going to miss inside. Moving the count to full. Full count, two outs here. All's on second. Hewitt in the batter's box. Arella winds. Swung on, fouled off.
Even if he doesn't get a base hit here, you'd love to see a walk bring up Freddie Matos, guy with batting 310. Fantastic hitter so far this season. Would love to see a guy who can really contribute get up to the plate with runners on.
And the seventh pitch of the at-bat to Hewitt's going to be ball four. Great at-bat there by the catcher, Duncan Hewitt.
Two on and two out. Third baseman, number seven, Freddie Matos.
So two outs and then two consecutive walks. One stolen base later, we have guys on first and second.
That's going to bring up the third baseman, Freddie Matos. Big opportunity here to take the lead back.
Yes, this could put Butler in a very commanding position. We can scratch across a few here with two outs.
Once again, a lefty versus lefty. And in Matos' first plate appearance, he did fly out to the center fielder, so able to make some contact on Arella, but now he needs to make some contact and find a base hit here.
Need that bat on ball contact and that ball on outfield grass contact. Maybe ball on tree contact.
Or how about ball on university terrace roof?
Hey man, I'll take whatever I can get. Maybe we can get some ball on canal contact. Splash zone.
As the count is 1-1 on Matos. Pitches, and that one's gonna.
Oh! Over the head of the left fielder, misjudged completely.
And that's gonna bring in all and Hewitt now. And the double from Jeff Matt. From Freddie Matos is going to bring two Butler runs in, and that's going to extend the lead to 3-1.
Dude, that left fielder for Villanova not having a great day today. A.J. Hansen has misjudged two balls that resulted in doubles for the Bulldogs. Obviously, first one just put a runner on second, and he came around to score. This one driving in two runs for the Dogs, and a runner now on second is Freddie Matos. Scored a hit as well.
So horribly judged by A.J. Hansen out there. His
more
first step was in. And
mental error rather than a fielding error.
Yes, but that ball from Freddie Matos did tail on him a little bit.
It looked like if it was down just a little bit, he would have had it played perfectly, but maybe the wind caught it and it just moved back up. Not much wind today, so I'd be really surprised. Just misjudged, went right over his head.
And with Matos on second, Brody McGrath steps into the box. McGrath had a single in his first plate appearance. Looking for another one to bring in Matos. As that pitch is going to miss inside. Moving the count to 1-1. Two outs here in the bottom of the third. Butler already has two in this inning.
Tyler Arella once again let down by his defense.
The 1-1 swung on and fouled back by the second baseman, Brody McGrath.
Brody McGrath taking his time, getting ready. Steps into the box.
So McGrath looking to bring in Matos. Azarella gets ready to pitch and he winds up. Pitch swung on and fouled out down the left field line by McGrath.
Yeah, that Matos McGrath senior to senior connection. Brody McGrath also swinging a pretty hot bat, 293 coming into the game. Already a base hit today, so up to 303 now. Not many Butler hitters hitting above the 300 mark. We have three of them in our lineup today.
The 1-2 is going to miss inside.
Whole bunch of twos here. Number two at the plate. Two balls, two outs, and two strikes. Two runs across in the inning already, and a runner on second.
Yes, twos are wild here. As the 2-2 pitch swung on. Oh, and that one's going to land about a foot foul of the left field line.
Yeah, it's one of those balls that if it was fair would have been just right to keep going all the way to the end of the wall there. Would have likely been another run for the Dogs. We'll see if we can keep it up here. And just for the fans at home, I did knock on wood. Not going to jinx our boys out here.
Arella gets his sign as the 2-2 is swung on and fouled off again. Brody McGrath putting up a rather stellar at bat up there.
Yeah, Brody McGrath extending this at bat. Arguably, some of these pitches he's swinging at, not the best, but anything close.
Fight off, foul off, and love to see another pitch.
Absolutely.
And it's for the third time this at-bat, the 2-2. Swung on, and this time McGrath is going to swing and miss, and that's going to end the inning here. But Butler did take the lead back on two runs off one hit.
Yeah, two walks, a stolen base.
And a nice double by Freddie Matos to bring in both runs in the bottom of the third. And after three, Butler leads 3-1 over Villanova. You're watching Butler Baseball on Butler Athletics YouTube Live. Back here at Bulldog Park for the top of the fourth inning. Butler versus Villanova, and the Dogs leading the Cats.
For Villanova.
3-1 here.
13, Dylan McNary.
McCauley back on the mound for his fourth inning of work here.
Yeah, two-out rally sparked by not base hits, but drawing walks. Calling all, hustling down to almost halfway down to first base on a pitch that was called a strike, got walked on the next pitch and ended up stealing second.
The first pitch from McCauley misses inside. And don't forget about the John McCauley stranding bases loaded. That might have created a little bit of momentum for the Butler bats.
Certainly did. There was a lot of pressure in that last half inning. Butler able to come away virtually unscathed, of course, giving up the tying run, but able to power home, too.
There's the shortstop. Dylan McNary steps in for the second time today.
McNary, the one who made a costly throw from his shortstop position, unable to get one of the runners, contributing to the errors from the defense of Villanova.
As the 2-0 pitch swung on by McNary. Looked like McNary was looking to swing at that pitch regardless of where it was. Took a nice hack and was a little early. And the 2-1, curveball swung on. That one's going to tail foul.
Looks like that one was just floating a little bit too much, and luckily the batter got out in front of it, forcing the foul ball there. That's the second time that McCauley has left a breaking pitch up in the zone. Not something you want to see too much of.
And the 2-2 to McNary swung on and popped out. Second baseman.
Tough play in the outfield.
Yes, second baseman Brody McGrath got called off by the right fielder who tried to make a diving catch but was unable to.
Well, it looked like that second baseman, like we were talking about, was tripping as he was trying to walk backwards for that play, and the right fielder making a last minute dive, still down on one knee.
That is Matt McElwain out there. A little shaken up after the diving attempt to try to catch that pop-up.
Yeah, it looked very, very split-second decision, and probably was not prepared to hit the ground that hard.
Yes, and Dylan McNary kind of found that that area out there that's kind of difficult to for a second baseman and right fielder to make a play. McNary on first, no outs here. First pitch swung on and missed by Jeff Manto.
That play ruled a hit, so the third today for Villanova. Butler with just one more hit than the Cats, but with the walks and base running, Butler able to scratch across three so far.
That 0-1's going to be right down the middle for strike two. Working ahead of Jeff Manto.
That's what you really want to see from John McCauley. Got to get ahead in counts early. He has struggled to put runners away and has gotten into a lot of hitters' counts.
As Villanova is 0-4 with the runners on scoring position as Dylan McNary steals second base right there.
Speaking of, a ball in the dirt, able to scoot away from the catcher just a bit there. Runner ends up at second. No more double play.
Villanova is 0-2 with runners in scoring position. McCauley's been pretty efficient here with runners on today, though. As the 1-2 misses high and inside.
So another count started out 0-2, and he struggled to put him away here. Checking the wristband.
Manto fouls that pitch off.
That one came right back at me.
So you have a couple layers of protection in front of us. One, the net behind home plate, and then
windows.
Some windows. Staying safe up here in the press box behind home plate. As the 2-2. Swung on, and that curveball is going to hit.
It's like it, if it hits the batter, that would send the runner back to second base.
And that will be would be correct. As that curveball did hit Jeff Manto.
So Dylan McNary, he was trying to advance an extra base on a steal a base on a walk. Back to second.
The left fielder.
It's gonna now give McCauley and his defense a force at third base here.
Yeah, force at every base now in the infield. Got first base and third base in on the corners. No sack bunts here.
And with...
though he squares up for it.
Squares up, pop the back. And that one's going to hit the netting. This is A.J. Hansen, the struggling left fielder defensively.
Though in his last at-bat, came up and had that single.
And he's batting with no outs and two on here. But Villanova still hitless with runners on base. And runners in scoring position.
Yeah, with two outs, Butler would love to keep it that way, but it will be a struggle. Might be a little harder than it is to say.
And that 0-1 swung on and missed by Hansen.
Yeah, the foul pop on that bunt essentially takes the bunt away, which is really going to help Butler's defense.
McCauley ahead 0-2. And that pitch is going to miss outside. Trying to get A.J. Hansen swinging.
Looks like that pitch might have just missed a little bit. Overthrown by McCauley.
McCauley. 1-2. Curveball misses a little high there. Hung that curveball up a little high,
yeah.
Trying to get a Hansen swinging.
Unable to bring those breaking pitches down in the zone. We saw one early, which missed outside.
The 2-2. And that one, nice block by the catcher, Duncan Hewitt, there.
Excellent plays by Duncan Hewitt behind the plate as McCauley has missed the zone quite a bit. Already a wild pitch.
Yes, a very nice block there, keeping McNary and Manto at second and first base with no outs here. Full count is full, 3-2, and that one's blocked, but regardless, that's going to be a ball, and that's going to load the bases with no outs here.
John McNary not putting himself in a very comfortable situation.
Number 4, the catcher.
Started off that at-bat, once again 0-2, and unable to put him away, ends up with a walk. Now the base is loaded for Will Reiner, the catcher.
And with no outs.
This is his first at-bat this season with the bases loaded. Villanova struggling to put up runs coming into this weekend series with Butler.
As the pitching coach, Ben Norton, is going to go talk to John McCauley. It's a big opportunity here for Villanova to get not only those two runs back that they gave up in the third, but take a lead here with no outs and bases loaded.
Yeah, with the lead and, you know, being early enough in the game, you want to think that they're going to let McCauley, you know, finish out here and at least wait till he gives up runs to pull him. And obviously they're keeping him out there, but maybe now they have someone warming up in the bullpen that'll maybe McCauley's just trying to keep everything in the infield and give him time, get warmed up.
And with no outs here and the ninth batter up, kind of struggling batting average, might we see him square around to try to get a sacrifice bunt down?
He certainly might, especially with no outs.
As Will Reiner, the catcher.
Yeah, struggled so far this year. Did 278 with runners in scoring position, not bad.
But first pitch swinging out to the center fielder, John Shoup. And that is going to try throw into third to keep the runner at second base. Smart play.
Yeah,
given
very,
the, giving up one run, yeah. Keeping the runner at second.
Very well played by the Butler defense. Obviously unfortunate to give up the run, but with a two-run lead, you have that cushion of you can give up a run, take the out, not make a stupid play, keep runners as far away from home plate as you can.
It's a very smart play by center fielder and freshman John Shoup to keep that runner at second base. Keep that double play available.
Yep, keep force outs at every base in the infield.
And both Villanova runs are coming off. Sacrifice flies to the center fielder. Still hitless with runners in scoring position and runners on base, but they're finding ways to steal bases and have timely hitting.
Yeah, Rotondo with a low batting average so far, but with runners in scoring position batting 391, he's already drawn a walk with runners in scoring position, as he did in his last at-bat.
Yes, Duncan Hewitt right now on his toes behind home plate as John McCauley has missed a few low, trying to keep those runners.
Yeah, you got to imagine without the glove of Hewitt behind the plate, how many more runs might have.
And Rotondo hits one to center field, hits off the second baseman. And the center fielder, Shoup, is not going to even throw it again, and that's going to tie the game up. Chris Rotondo getting Villanova's first hit with runners on today and tying this game.
Bit of cat and mouse being played already here today. Butler taking a lead, Villanova tying. Butler taking another lead, and Villanova ties it up again. Now 3-3. You got to question how much longer McCauley is going to be in the game today, serving up a lot of walks already. Obviously, Nova hadn't not having many hits with runners in scoring position or runners on base, and still they've scored three runs. So somewhere there's mistakes happening. A lot of it has been McCauley missing the plate consistently, batters on 0-2 counts and not being able to finish them off.
And McCauley has got the runner at second picked off. That's going to be out number two. Great move by John McCauley to get the runner.
Yeah, we've seen him throw a couple of those fakes earlier in previous innings. Runner's not biting, but this time.
And that was A.J. Hansen struggling a little bit today on the diamond.
Yep, not having a great day in the outfield or on the base pads.
And that's going to move two outs here in the top of the fourth. With Rotondo standing on second base.
Rotondo, bit of a speed threat, four steals already, hasn't been thrown out yet.
As Nick LaRusso stands in the box, and John McCauley wants the sign to be repeated. I'm unable to see who it is, but it does look like there is a pitcher warming up in Butler bullpen behind the left field wall.
Yeah, hard to see because of our aforementioned barn, the indoor hitting facility that is outdoors. Blocks the bullpen, so hard to see what's going on, but clearly someone on the mound.
Count move 2-1, two outs here. Swung on and missed.
Those are the kinds of swings that McCauley has been hoping for. Villanova hitters doing a pretty good job of not chasing.
Yes.
But he gets Rotondo there.
So Villanova have been very disciplined at the plate. So it was really one of the first ones that I can think of that a Villanova hitter went swinging outside of the strike zone. There's the 2-2. High and outside.
Yeah, now with two strikes again. Villanova batter Chris Rotondo. Keeping that strike zone tight yet again.
It is actually Nick LaRusso batting, Rotondo standing on second.
You're right. Excuse me.
And that's going to.
And now LaRusso standing on first.
And that's going to bring up the best Wildcat hitter, Ryan Torres.
Ryan Torres with more walks than hits. No pitcher wants first to pitch baseman, to this guy
Ryan,
this year.
Ryan Torres.
But with runners on first and second, there's really nowhere to put him. course, having already given up two runs in this inning, going to be tough to see what they do here with John McCauley still on the mound.
McCauley has had trouble today with walks, walking six batters.
In the zone there, strike one.
Pitch to me looked a little high, but the home plate umpire gave McCauley the benefit of the doubt. As he is ahead 0-1 on Torres and gets him swinging again.
Yeah, big swing there from Torres.
McCauley has been able to get a lot of hitters in this 0-2 count, but struggles to put the hitters down.
Yeah, not sure what it is, whether he's intentionally trying to get, you know, outside pitches and they're just not hitting, but he hits there on the inside half.
He goes right at Torres there, and a nice fist pump from the catcher, Hewitt. Excited for John McCauley here.
Yeah. Two hits, two runners left on base.
Gave up the two runs, but with runners on first and second facing the best batter in the Big East, like we said, he's been walked more than he's been thrown to. So McCauley taking on the big kahuna strikes him out.
It's a big pitch there, McCauley, to end the inning and stop the bleeding a little bit. But as Chuck said, Villanova does tie the game back up 3-3 after the top of the fourth inning. You're watching Butler Baseball on Butler Athletics YouTube Live. Back here at Bulldog Park on the campus of Butler University for Butler Baseball, taking on the Wildcats from Villanova here in Butler's first Big East home series of the year. The score is all tied as Villanova did score two runs in the top of this fourth inning. Matt McElwain is leading off for Butler, and Tyler Arella is back on the mound as pitch number one misses high and outside to Matt McElwain. In McElwain's first plate appearance, he was able to get an RBI off the air from the shortstop, Dylan McNary. As the count moves to 1-1, and Arella pitches inside and almost hits the knee of Matt McElwain. The 2-1 swung on and missed, moving the count to 2-2. Both teams have three runs along with four hits. Villanova has one error. As the 2-2 misses outside, moving the count to full. As the count runs full, Arella misses high, and McElwain's going to start the inning off with a walk.
16, AJ Pointer.
Looking to get those runs back that they gave up in the top of this inning. That's going to bring up the shortstop, AJ Pointer. He singled in his first plate appearance. Big Big lead from McIlwain as Pointer squares around a bunt but pulls back. But the pitch is called strike regardless. Count 0-1 here for Tyler Arella. Winds and deals and fouled off the tennis bubble by the shortstop AJ Pointer. If you're just joining us here, Butler and Villanova are tied 3-3 in the bottom of the fourth inning. Matt McIlwain drew a first at-bat walk.
Just one stolen base on the season, but also never been caught. And with a single in his first at-bat, we might see maybe a hit and run here with no outs.
As the 1-2 from Arella swung on and fouled off by Pointer.
Staying alive here with two strikes.
It's a beautiful day for baseball here. Not a cloud in my view here.
Oh, perfect baseball weather. On this lovely spring day here towards the end of April.
As the 1-2 is swung on and hit out to right field for a second hit today by AJ Pointer. Moving Matt McIlwain to second base, and Butler has something cooking here.
39, John Shoup.
And this is going to bring up the center fielder, John Shoup. Big opportunity here with runners on first and second, no outs.
Yeah, the freshman center fielder has been the guy making the catches on the sack flies so far for Villanova, here with a chance to bring in at least one of his own. This is what Butler has to do. String hits together. Be productive with all your at-bats.
As Shoup squares around the bunt and goes to the first baseman, the Tours is going to throw to third base, and that's not what John Shoup or Butler was looking for here. As Tours throws a strike to the third baseman, LaRusso.
Yeah, attempted sacrifice bunt there would have had runners on second and third had it gone to plan. Unfortunately, the lefty Shoup squaring up a bit early. First baseman able to come in and be right there. And that bunt just died off the bat, which normally, you know, we'd like to see, but first baseman able to make a fantastic play defensively.
Yes, and with the third baseman staying home, he needs to try to get that bunt down the third baseline rather than to the charging first baseman.
Absolutely. Ryan Tours able to cut off the runner at third, so first and second still, one out now.
James Gargano looking for his first hit of the day, 0-2. But has an opportunity here to drive in a run as the 1-0 is popped up in between the second and right fielder and the second baseman able to make the catch, and that's two quick outs for Villanova here.
Yep, after Butler getting it started, quick two hits. Unfortunately, they've been able to turn it around. Awfully quick. Colin All came up with a walk last time. Came around to score after the stolen base. And now a gathering on the mound here for Villanova.
After two quick outs for Villanova here, the pitching coach from the Wildcats wants to go talk to his pitcher with Colin All stepping to the plate and two guys on base. Butler didn't look like they had something cooking here early in the fourth inning, but two quick outs from Arella puts Butler in a little bit of a pickle here.
Yeah, when it comes to hitting situationally, calling all, not having a great season so far, just a 188 average, on base percentage of 316, but with runners in scoring position, 333, and with two outs, he's hitting 429. So in this specific situation, although not a great hitter generally so far this season, could be just the right time for calling all to come up big.
Calling all also hasn't had that many plate appearances, so maybe he might be due for one here. Big hit to get his season jump started.
Yeah, three hits here in his first 16 at-bats.
Zarella is going to stay on the mound. And Colinall steps in the box. Pointer first, Pointer at second, Shoup at first. Two outs in the bottom of the fourth. We're all tied 3-3. And that pitch outside.
Very close play at first base. Shoup just back in time.
His catcher, Will Rayner, caught that ball a little bit outside and saw that Shoup took a little bit of lead, so he tried to pick off Shoup at first.
Yeah, hard to tell, but it might have looked like the first base umpire might not have had the best angle on that one, unable to see what's going on the front half, which is where the play took place. Certainly began his dive early enough.
And the 1-0 to all fouled off. And fouled him, hit him in the batter's box. And that's going to be a strike one.
Colinall has not left the park yet this year. One triple so far. DH could be looking to get swinging here. Would really help the Butler lineup.
And then the 1-1 to all. Swung on, curveball, hang on over, but it's caught by the shortstop, Dylan McNary, to end the inning.
That one on a line right to the shortstop. Unable to bring any runners in to score this inning.
Butler had one walk and one hit in the bottom of the fourth inning, but did strand two. That's going to do it for the fourth inning here. You're watching Butler Baseball on Butler Athletics YouTube Live. Back here at Bulldog Park, you're watching Butler versus Villanova, all squared up at three runs apiece. John McCauley making his fifth inning of work.
Top of the fifth for Villanova, right fielder 36. Yeah,
struggled a little bit in that fourth inning, but might be taking the mound again in the fifth because he's fared well against the 4, 5, and 6 hitters.
That he has a walk in the third was O'Reilly's last at bat, so. Looking to get an early out here.
And that first pitch is fouled off the foot of the Villanova right fielder, Jack O'Reilly.
Maybe going to dig in a little bit more in the box.
McCauley is once again working ahead, but just been unable to finish some hitters off once he gets ahead.
Yeah, it's been a rough go for John McCauley today on the mound. Lots of walks, missing the zone quite often.
And the 0-1 curveball.
That one finds it.
Freezes O'Reilly in the box. one of those curveballs that was kind of left over the plate, but O'Reilly really wasn't expecting it. And the 0-2 fouled off.
Yeah, it's one of those things. McCauley is, I think that was the first time he's made the pitch where he's attempted to throw that high curveball just to freeze a guy, and it ends up out of the zone, so people just take it for that ball. But finally able to hit that pitch, freeze the batter, did exactly what he wanted it to. Had him 0-2. We'll see if he can finish him off here quickly.
Count 1-2. And there's that curveball again, and he gets O'Reilly popped up, but the sun plays a factor for Dan Harwood, and he's unable to make that catch.
Yeah, an unfortunate play there. Very bright sun out here today. Like we said, no clouds in the sky, which can be a negative in some cases. Could be nice sometimes to have that sun go behind a cloud.
And that
runner on first,
yeah, on the first baseman Dan Harwood. Unfortunate for John McCauley, he threw a nice curveball, got the batter to pop one up.
Yeah, really, that's the unfortunate situation. The first time that he's been able to dominate early in the count and produce an out pitch before losing the at bat. Defense unable to make the play.
Cameron Hassert squares around. And that's going to be ball two from John McCauley. Butler still has a pitcher working in the bullpen, as does Villanova.
Like they're starting to get one warming up.
McCauley checks the runner at first. Squares around a bunt. And that one's going to miss for ball three.
Yeah, that error might have gotten in the head of John McCauley, who was so confident with those first few pitches. Now three straight balls.
And the 3-0 is going to be right down the middle for strike number one.
Yep, McCauley with now a 6.12 ERA. Whip
squares
above.
Around the bunt. It's right to pitcher McCauley, and go throws the first for out number one.
All right, well, the pitcher makes the play himself. Can't mess it up when you're the one doing it.
Shortstop 13, Dylan McNary.
That's going to bring up the shortstop, Dylan McNary.
McNary, who ended the last half inning with a line drive. It was hit right at him by Colin All. Runners on first and second. Looked like might have brought home one.
The runner on second is Jack O'Reilly. McNary in the box and McCauley on the mound. That's pitch number one to McNary. Misses low and outside.
Lots of Irish names in this at bat.
That one is 2-0, and McCauley finds himself behind the hitter.
Yet again, McCauley, he had three straight balls, and then that got the freebie strike one.
A 2-0 swung on deep to center field, but John Shoup gets under it and throws it back in, and the runner O'Reilly is going to retreat back to second base.
Excellent. Well, very well played by the center fielder, John Shoup.
Designated hitter, number 9, Jeff Manto.
Able to track that one down in center field and keep the runner at second base, most importantly. It's such a strange statistical day when we look at Butler, who's been able to string some hits and, you know, actually bring runners home. Villanova also able to bring runners home. Not many hits, though, and not many hits with runners on.
Yes, Villanova only does have that one hit with one runner on, but two sacrifice flies have provided most of the offense for Villanova today. As the 0-1 is fouled down the left field line to the track.
Important to clarify, we're talking about a running track, not the warning track.
Yes, and center fielder John Shoup has been pretty busy out there today in the outfield.
Yes, indeed, making great plays. Almost got picked off at first, but lucky call kept him at first.
McCauley ahead 0-2. That one swung on. And that one looks like it's going to foul off the tennis bubble.
Yep, that one coming off the bat very nicely. Designated hitter Jeff Manto kind of staring at it, just watching it. Kept his bat in the air.
Hey, nine. Go, nine.
Wind starting to pick up now, blowing almost straight in, maybe a little bit to the right in from center field.
And the 0-2 is going to miss inside. Almost hit Jeff Manto.
Two outs and two strikes. Really would like to see McCauley able to finish this at bat strong. Keep runners off the bases.
Curveball. It's going to miss low, but nice block, and able to track it down was the catcher, Duncan Hewitt.
Got to imagine the glove and the mobility of Duncan Hewitt has saved the most runs. Just keeping batters and runners at the same spots and not letting them move up with all the pitches in the dirt.
2-2. Count. Ball missed, and that's going to move the count full with two outs. You're in the top of the fifth inning. The runner on second is Jack O'Reilly. John McCauley working in his fifth inning.
McCauley able to strike out the big hitter, Ryan Tours, to end the last inning, but not able to finish off here as he walks the number seven hitter, Jeff Manto.
That's going to be John McCauley's seventh walk of today.
Looking for action in the Butler bullpen, but
number one, AJ Hansen.
Nobody walking down yet.
We'd have to assume they're banking on McCauley to get this last out of the fifth inning. And that first pitch is going to be a missed low and outside.
So started off 0-2, ended up walking him, and now another ball to start off the next at-bat. John McCauley shaking out there on the mound.
McCauley's second pitch of that bat, that one is fouled. And that one's going to be a nice play by the second baseman, Brody McGrath, to track that ball down. It looked like Dan Harwood, the first baseman, could not see that ball again with the sun, but Brody McGrath came out of nowhere and was able to track that ball down to end the inning.
Yeah, really unfortunate. Lost the ball on that first play, lost the ball on that second play. Excellent play by the second baseman to end the inning.
Yes, and that's going to do it for the top of the fifth inning.
And that's why you always back up every play. We saw behind the plate and behind first base, our catcher today, Duncan Hewitt, right, has made great plays backing up everybody, blocking pitches that would have gone by. And then we see, right, they had three players over there, second baseman, first baseman, and the right fielder, all of them active on that ball. Great play by the second baseman to come through after the first baseman, Dan Harwood, lost it in the sun.
It's Butler Villanova all scored at three. You're watching Butler Baseball on Butler Athletics YouTube Live. And we are back here at Bulldog Park for the bottom of the fifth inning.
For the Bulldogs, First baseman 41,
leading
Dan
off
Harwood.
For the Bulldogs is the first baseman, Dan Harwood.
Dan Harwood involved with two plays, one to start the inning, one to end the inning. Lost the ball in the sun twice. Maybe we can get something going on offense.
Yes, the Butler.
Make up for it.
Butler's best hitter has 0 for 2 today, looking for his first hit. And that is going to be strike one.
That pitch looked a bit outside, but getting the call. Isarella still out there.
Arella's 0-1 pitch is fouled. And the count moves to 0-2.
Harwood batting 364 when he's batting leadoff. He usually has a pretty solid chance here.
And that curveball from Arella is going to freeze Harwood.
Got him on the outside. You could see there already Harwood was checking his swing, so he clearly thought it was out of the zone. Umpire rings him up.
Yes, Harwood did not like that call. Thought it was out, but umpire called strike. And that's going to bring up the catcher, Duncan Hewitt. First pitch swinging.
Talk about a guy who's been active today, not only on defense, but of course had that double in the second inning that started off Butler's run scoring that inning. Or was the only run, excuse me, in that inning for Butler. But the first run of the game, all important first run.
Arella steps off. Back on the mound. And the 0-1 is a strike. And the wind on the deal in the 0-2. Misses outside. Before that ball, that was five straight strikes for Tyler Arella, striking out Dan Harwood and then having Duncan Hewitt down in the count. And that pitch is going to miss high, moving the count to 2-2. Going to miss inside, moving the count 3-2.
Yeah, good eye by Hewitt not to swing at the low pitch there.
It always seems to figure that the catcher might have the best eye, knowing that where the umpire's strike zone is.
Yeah, also being able to, you know, if an umpire calls a strike that he's might think is a ball, is a place to call for a pitch next inning.
And that's going to be the third time Duncan Hewitt is on the base pass today with a double and two walks.
Yep, that his sixth walk now on the year.
And that's going to bring up Freddie Matos with one out and one on here in the bottom of the fifth inning. Butler and Villanova are all tied up at three.
Yeah, Freddie Matos with the big double, of course, in the third inning.
And Hewitt goes, and he's going to be safe.
Stolen base for Duncan Hewitt, his first on the season. Now at 100% stolen base completion.
Whatever you call that, a little wild pitch or a miscatch by the catcher allows Hewitt to get in there safely without a throw.
Yeah, it looked like, you know, he caught it, and then all of a sudden it was behind him. So, little error by the catcher.
Yes, and big opportunity here for Freddie Matos. Moving the count to 2-0 here with one out here, and Duncan Hewitt standing on second base.
Butler doing a great job working into hitters' counts. Matos thrives with runners in scoring position. Runners on base hitting 375, scoring position 333. And I mean, with a regular average of 315, you got to believe that's happening a lot more often for him than it is for other guys.
And the 2-0 misses outside. Norella down in the count 3-0 to Freddie Matos. With runners on today, Butler is batting 4 of 12. And the 3-0 to Matos misses high, and that's going to be four straight balls and back-to-back walks.
With a talented hitter like Matos and a runner already in scoring position, maybe not an intentional walk, but clearly worked around him, and it looks like that's going to be it for Tyler Arella today.
That is indeed going to be it for the starting pitcher for Villanova, Tyler Arella. He did go 4 1/3 inning, giving up 3 runs off 5 hits.
Kept his team in the game.
That's going to be Cole Vanderslice, the pitcher, replacing Tyler Arella.
I wonder if people with last names like Vanderslice know that their kid has to play baseball. There are some names you just don't find in any other place besides pro sports.
Taking over on the mound, number 25, Cole Vanderslice.
Vanderslice, as we did mention, on the bump now for Villanova. He will be coming on with two Butler runners on base.
Bulldog second baseman, number 2, Brody McGrath.
Coming in with a 9.00 ERA, somebody Butler could look to take advantage of as he enters the game.
And Brody McGrath stepping in the batter's box right now after making that great defensive play to end the inning.
See if he can bring his great play around to home plate as well.
Hewitt is on second. Matos is on first.
That one definitely got him.
And that one hit Brody McGrath, and that's going to load the bases.
Looked like it got him on that front arm there. That's why you wear the elbow protector.
And it looks like we're going to have a pinch hitter here for Butler. And that is going to be the senior infielder, number 3, Andy Bennett, pinch hitting.
For Butler, number 3, Andy Bennett.
Andy Bennett with already 11 RBIs on the season. A great guy coming up to the plate with runners in scoring position. Batting 300 in that situation.
Bennett at the plate, first pitch swinging. And that one's going to be a diving catch by the right fielder. Throw play at home.
A fantastic catch, and that ball gets by the catcher. Fantastic play all around by the Bulldogs.
Yes, Duncan Hewitt tags up from third base and is able to score.
Andy Bennett doing exactly what a pinch hitter is supposed to do, bring in the run. It's a great matchup out there with a lefty, righty on lefty.
AJ Pointer.
comes in, not able to elevate that pitch quite as much as he would have liked to. Great swing though, brings home a run, and on a bad throw in from the center, from the right fielder, Butler able to move runners up to second and third.
With the shortstop AJ Pointer up, with two outs here, runner second, third, another opportunity for Butler to get a multiple run lead. This is the third time Butler has had the lead today, leading 1-0, 3-1, and now 4-3.
And 3-1 as well. 1-0, 3-1, and 4-3. Looking to create separation are the Dogs. Batter calls time.
Evander Slice winds, and that 1-0 pitch is going to be called strike.
First run coming in, obviously not an earned run for Evander Slice, but that runner on second was the first batter he faced.
And that pitch is going to miss outside. Matos is on third, and McGrath on second. Pointer in the box, and Vander Slice on the mound. The wheel and deal on the 2-1 pitch, misses outside, and count moves to 3-1 on Pointer.
Hitters count here, and with runners on second and third, could spell trouble here. Dugout and the stands having some good candor.
And the 3-1 is going to miss outside, and that's going to load the bases again. This time with two outs, and this time with John Shoup in the batter's box.
With two singles already on the day, a single here would be huge for the Dogs. Gives them a chance to bring home another one. Looking for the young center fielder to capitalize here, big for the Dogs.
It's a big opportunity for the freshman.
And a great matchup with the righty on lefty here.
And that first pitch is going to be a ball. And that's five straight balls, I believe, for the pitcher, Cole Vander Slice.
Yeah, having a rough introduction here. Butler able to do exactly what they wanted. Vander Slice with high opponent averages with two outs, runners on.
The Bulldogs certainly would take anything here. And then that's the hit by pitch that.
Hit by pitch comes around to score. Not sure that was a walk quite yet.
I think he thought it hit him, but the home plate umpire is saying no.
Interesting. So Shoup's stepping back in, but with that wild pitch and a run did cross.
Yeah, it's going to be a wild pitch, and I believe Matos is going to come around to score off that wild pitch.
So now runners on, still runners on second and third. After having the bases loaded.
Villanova head coach might be arguing right now that with Shoup selling the hit by pitch, that his catcher might have stopped going after that pass ball.
Yeah, and throwing the bat there is really the difference maker.
Now the umpires are going to meet here. Currently, as it stands, Matos did score with McGrath moving to third and Pointer moving to second, and John Shoup coming back from first to be in the batter's box. Currently, the score is 5-3.
And with the count 1-0, clearly that Shoup thought the ball hit him. Wasn't a walk. Wasn't in any count to put him on base, but now they are awarding the batter first base.
Looks like he did get hit by that pitch. Maybe the first base umpire, or maybe the The second base umpire did see that ball make contact with John Shoup's leg.
And now Vanderslice looks like he's getting removed from this game after quick work by the Dogs, able to bring in a couple runs.
And as I was saying right before John Shoup took that pitch, I was like, Butler was looking for any way to get a run here, and they got it by a hit-by-pitch.
Sometimes you take what you can get. Base is loaded again. So Butler now a 5-3 lead, but you gotta wonder, right, with James Gargano coming to the plate, John Shoup, our last batter. James Gargano coming to the plate, not a very successful day so far, so might have actually been not that terrible of a move to put another runner on.
And that's gonna be Cameron Mathis on the mound for Villanova. Mathis has a 4.85 ERA. This will be his 12th appearance on the season.
Yeah, Mathis with 21 strikeouts on the season, just 4 walks. So although the ERA is a little bit high, still able to have a pretty good season here.
So Mathis will be tasked with having bases loaded in the top of the order for Butler coming to the plate.
James Gargano not having the best day at the plate so far here, struck out twice. Looking to turn things around here. Maybe a new pitcher is exactly what Gargano needs. He only faced Tyler Arella, and more Bulldog batters have had better at-bats here against Vanderslice, so maybe Mathis can continue for the Dogs. We can have some better at-bats.
As the runners retreat back to their respective base, McGrath is at third, A.J. Pointer at second,
the Bulldog left fielder,
and John Shoup is at first.
James Gargano.
Gargano is going to step in the plate, 0-for-3 today, looking to get his first hit in a big opportunity here to extend that lead even bigger than 2. Butler leads 5-3 currently in the bottom of the 5th.
Butler with another 2-out rally. Keep it going, Gargano.
Cameron Mathis looking to make his first pitch of the game. And his first pitch is swung on and whiffed by James Gargano.
Good to see Gargano putting swings out with runners on and 2 outs. Just got to keep his head down, make sure he's watching the pitch all the way in, not pulling his head too far, too fast.
And the 0-1 is popped up. It looks like it's going over by the Villanova dugout. And that ball's going to...
Catcher stumbling as the field ends rather abruptly there and into a little more concrete type ground.
It looked like the catcher, Will Rayner, had the ball in his mitt, but when his hand came down, it made contact with that concrete wall back there. Popped out.
It looked like he was playing it right and did everything perfectly, just situationally because of the how the ground is right there, a lot tougher, and probably messed up his cleat. Tripped there, and as he was falling, like you said, glove hit the wall, popped the ball out.
Make note that Butler hasn't had a hit in this inning, but a couple walks and a couple hit by pitches is going to lead to a big inning. And that one's going to be hit up to and out to center field as McGrath comes home and Pointer comes home, and that's going to be the 4th run of the inning for Butler, extending the lead 7-3.
James Gargano, a rough day coming into this appearance. Struck out looking, grounded out, and popped out. Fantastic, fantastic play. Sent that ball straight up the middle, under the pitcher's glove, through his legs.
And that It's going to be the first hit of the inning for Butler, and that's going to bring two runs in.
Butler now a 7-3 lead, much more commanding, and looking to hand it over to the bullpen. Finishing would be a great way for Butler to pick up this win and take home our fourth straight series win against Villanova.
And pinch hitting for Collinall is Aaron Steinhardt.
Aaron Steinhardt, sophomore, leading the team in home runs with 4, as well as leading the team in RBIs with 19.
And the first pitch for Mathis is called strike 1. 2 runners on, 2 outs. 4 runs have scored on this bottom of the 5th inning. And Aaron Steinhardt at the plate for the first time today. The 0-1 to Steinhardt is a curveball and misses high.
Two runners on. Steinhardt, big hitter for the Dogs. Slugging 507 coming into this at bat. 450 with runners in scoring position.
The 1-1 swung on and missed.
Big swing there by Steinhardt. Looking to do some damage on that one. That's a University Terrace swing if I ever saw one.
And it would also extend Butler's lead if he got a piece of one here.
Can never have too many insurance runs, as we've learned with Villanova catching up every time Butler extends the lead.
That one swung on and fouled off. As Chuck just mentioned, every time Butler scored, Villanova would come back and match at the next inning.
Hopefully with a 4-run difference, we can maybe have a little bit more security on our lead.
Steinhardt choking up pretty big on the bat. Looking to choke and poke one here. And that pitch is going to miss high.
That pitch looked pretty good. Got me tensed up here in the booth.
Two, two count, 2 outs, 2 on. Mathis, that one's going to miss outside. Moving the count full.
Excellent takes here by Ryan Steinhardt. It can be really hard to come into a game and just be expected to produce. Steinhardt, of course, showing the power numbers for Butler so far, but doing a great job here as a pinch hitter, not swinging too freely.
On the pitch, both runners will be moving as there they go and swung on. That one's going to go to the center fielder, bringing one in. Schrag calling around.
Very aggressive call. Safe at home. Excellent slide by Gargano. No chance at the plate. Able to slide underneath the tag. Fantastic base running. Excellent slide by Gargano. Extends the lead 9-3.
And Schrag being aggressive there with Gargano.
Butler having a tough time getting going early against Arella, but ever since they took him out, both replacement pitchers, Mathis and previously Vanderslice, giving up a lot of runs, a lot of hits. Butler is firing on all cylinders. 2-out rally. That's exactly what we like to see.
Yes, 4 runs off of 2 outs here for Butler.
And of course, like we had talked about, not many hits early in this inning, bringing runs home. Lots of wild pitches and hit batsmen.
Yes, Butler has 9 runs and only 7 hits. And they have been walked 6 times and have two batters been hit by pitches.
Yeah, those last 2 singles able to bring home runs, clear the bases. Butler putting up big numbers here in the fifth.
And Steinhardt on first base. Dan Harwood back in for the third time today. He is hitless with two strikeouts.
Steinhardt, like many other Butler players, just one steal on the season and in one attempt.
Dan Harwood down 0-2 to Mathis. And the 0-2 pitches swung on and fouled off, and that one's going to end up inside the track.
Harwood coming into this series, a very productive hitter, not been so far today for the Dogs. Striking out twice and flying out to the right fielder. Looking to go 1-for-3 here, keep this inning alive.
And that one's going to be a pass ball, or a wild pitch there, blocked by the catcher Rayner, and Steinhardt is able to steal second.
2-for-2 now with Steinhardt on the base paths. Butler bringing up their stolen base numbers in this game. Right, coming in with just 7 on the team, and it feels like we've seen 3 or 4 already here.
The 1-2 to Harwood is fouled off.
Harwood doing a great job staying alive.
He's fighting off a lot of pitches here to stay alive after being down in the count 0-2.
Umpire needing to reload here, as many balls have been fouled off.
You have a good crowd here in attendance today at Bulldog Park. As the 1-2 pitch to Mathis, or to Harwood, is fouled off again.
Harwood doing a great job of staying alive. Got to look to put one in the outfield.
Big inning here. Harwood looking to increase that lead here for Butler. Bulldogs are leading 9-3 in the bottom of the fifth, as the 1-2 is missed outside.
Probably the biggest thing we can attribute to Butler's success offensively, not swinging the pitches outside the zone, working counts, drawing walks. Obviously, they've had a couple hit batsmen. Not making it hard on themselves, putting them in great situations.
Harwood called time. Putting up a great at-bat after being down 0-2. Fouling off some pitches and taking a couple balls. Cameron Mathis is ready. Deals, and that one's fouled off by Dan Harwood.
Dan Harwood putting together a great at-bat here. If he can keep fouling pitches off, maybe just wait until puts a mistake over the plate, does Mathis.
The 2-2 to Harwood, swung on, and that one's hit deep out into right field. And that one's gonna go
over the fence. Dan Harwood, 0-for-3 coming into this at bat. Shows that with one swing of the bat, you can turn your whole day around. Number 41 puts that pretty far into the parking lot.
He definitely put a charge into that one and flew it out to deep right field.
Tyler Arella clearly was the constraint there on Butler's offense, because as soon as this is the first inning, he's not been working. Cameron Mathis and Cole Vanderslice have not been able to keep up where Arella had been so successful. Butler tallying 8 times.
Yes, very big inning here for the Bulldogs here, taking a commanding lead here. Now leading by eight, after eight, in the bottom of the fifth inning. Mathis now working for the first time with a Clare base pass after the home run from Dan Harwood. And batting now is the catcher, Duncan Hewitt, who has been a star not only offensively but defensively, scoring two runs, being on base all three times. And
yeah, Duncan Hewitt working a walk earlier in this inning.
Yes.
Scored three times today. Doing a great job on the base pass for the Dogs.
That pitch is going to be a called strike. Villanova has a pitcher warming up in the bullpen. And the 2-1 to Duncan Hewitt is going to be a hit by pitch, and that's the third hit by pitch this inning. And that's going to be the fourth time Duncan Hewitt is going to be running the bases today.
And it looks like that's going to be it for Cameron Mathis. The third pitching change in this inning for Villanova. All of this coming with two outs.
Yes, Butler putting the hurt on here in the fifth inning. This will be the fourth pitcher of the inning.
Yeah, the fourth different pitcher used by the Wildcats.
And it's going to be the 12th batter batting this inning for Butler. Given the Butler starting pitcher, John McCauley, a commanding lead. We might not see John McCauley, but this would definitely put him in contention for getting that win.
Yeah, certainly is just an interesting situation all around. It's been a tight game up until this inning.
Taking over on the mound.
Thinking John McCauley was shaking out there with the game being as close as it was. Now with, you know, such a big lead, will we maybe see him back out there? I mean, he's only given up, right, if we're being honest, he's only given up three runs, limiting hits with runners on. He's missed the plate, obviously, more than we would like to see. But three runs on four hits, you know, through five innings, not a bad day.
I mean, I have to think
all walks aside,
John McCauley's day might be done after taking a half hour off almost in this half inning for the Butler offense.
Certainly, pitchers can get cold when your offense is doing so well. So like we've been saying, it's hard to see who is warming up out there for Butler behind the fence. So quite possibly could have gone to the bullpen to stay warm during this extended offensive inning.
And so far this inning, Butler has scored eight runs.
Number seven, third base.
Off of only three or four hits, I believe.
Yeah, not many hits either for either team. Just eight hits for the Dogs and four hits for Villanova.
But a lot of
hits coming now that Tyler Arella is out of the game.
Yes, a lot of offense being produced now. A lot of walks today, 13 combined between the two teams. And three Butler batters have been hit.
Wildcats now using freshman pitcher Danny Wilkinson.
Wilkinson working with one on.
That ball almost hit our boy Freddie Matos to start the at-bat.
Danny Wilkinson is the second lefty that Villanova has brought to the mound today.
Matos with a walk as well already in this inning.
As Wilkinson's 1-0 count is fouled off by the third baseman, Freddie Matos. Called time by the home plate umpire.
Freddie Matos looking to give low bones to the ump, who turns down the fist bump. probably good to stay as impartial as possible.
As the 1-1 from Danny Wilkinson is called strike. Would have to think after this long inning, anything close to the plate, the umpire might be calling a strike.
Certainly, we'll be trying to keep it even between the two teams.
The runner, but he's going to call strike three regardless. As I said, the home plate umpire might be calling anything close, as he did, because I thought that pitch was a ball.
That pitch looked pretty clearly outside and low, for sure. I thought definitely a ball, but umpire calling strike three.
But regardless of that, Butler did hang eight on the board that inning with three hits only. But three hits batters and three walks is going to do a lot for a pitcher. And it looks like John McCauley's day on the bump is done, as he is standing in the dugout right now. And it's going to be a new pitcher today. It looks like number 36, Scott Wright.
Scott Wright, the senior, just 5 appearances, all of them single inning appearances. Shocked to see him already on the mound. Would have figured we'd see him close to the end, but not now, obviously not a save situation.
Kelly versus Arpaia.
Defensive changes
one
for the Bulldogs.
ERA of 188.
Scott Wright.
For Scott Wright.
Playing first base, number 3, Andy Bennett. And the right fielder is 41, Dan Harwood.
And before this inning, we're going to take a little break here. Butler leading Villanova 11-3. You're watching Butler Baseball on Butler Athletics YouTube Live. Welcome back to Bulldog Park here for the 6th inning. The Wildcats are coming to the plate after Butler hung 8 on the board last inning, taking an 11-3 lead.
Yeah, Butler doing exactly what we've been looking for them to do. String hits together, though, clearly not many, just 3 or 4 there. But able to string good at-bats together, working walks, not swinging at any bad pitches, able to take advantage of some wild pitches finally from Villanova, and able absolutely to destroy the new pitching. Tyler Arella had been pretty dominant on the mound, limiting the Dogs to very few hits. Had 3 or 4 hits coming into the inning, now with 8 hits.
That's going to give a comfortable lead for the new Butler pitcher, Scott Wright.
That ball yet again coming right back off the foul tip.
I think both Chuck and I had a little flinch at that one.
Yeah, I think we both froze. A little deer in the headline moments, knowing it was going to get caught by the net. And a little 3D moment.
Scott Wright ahead of Rainer 0-2. And the 0-2 pitch hit to the first baseman. Looks like
Andy
Aaron
Bennett.
Steinhardt at first base now.
It's Andy Bennett out there.
Oh, Andy Bennett. Yes, sorry.
Fielder number 8, Chris Rotondo.
Who came in to pinch hit in the last inning.
What?
Chris Rotondo at the plate. RBI single in his last at-bat, though with no one on, no one to drive in.
And former first baseman Dan Harwood has now moved on to right field. As Scott Wright has to be pitching with some confidence right now after Butler put on 8, as that pitch is swung on and lifted to deep center field. But John Shoup, the busy man out there today,
Yeah, he is.
Able to track that one down.
He's gotten balls hit right at him all day. Able to judge him pretty well. Had no problems today.
LaRusso.
Butler looking for a 1-2-3 inning here after putting eight on the board.
Scott Wright coming into this appearance, just five innings pitched. And keeping a pretty low ERA, came into the inning with a 1.8, now down to 1.59. Excellent performances from Scott Wright.
Nick LaRusso is going to be standing in there for the third, for the fourth time today.
Yeah, when a guy has numbers like that, though, you more expect them to be in a closing type role. Obviously not a save situation, but you would have thought that they would have kept their low work, high efficiency guy for the end of the game.
As that 1-0 pitch swung on by LaRusso is going to be caught by the second baseman, Brody McGrath, to end the inning, and that's going to be a 1-2-3 for Scott Wright. Very efficient inning there after scoring eight. And that's going to do it for the top of the sixth inning.
Hey, great job by the Dogs. Andy Bennett taking over at first base, also having some issues, losing the ball in the sun, but McGrath able to come over and make the play yet again.
Of all the contests and much more.
Yes, and after five and a half innings, Butler is leading 11-3 over Villanova. And you're watching Butler Baseball on Butler Athletics YouTube Live. Welcome back to the bottom of the sixth inning at Bulldog Park. Butler taking on Villanova in this third game of a three-game series against the Wildcats in this rubber match, looking to take the series and win their first Big East series of the year. After having a big inning last inning, scoring eight to take an eight-run lead, Butler is going to be looking to extend that a little more and put it out of reach for the Wildcats to make a comeback. Brody McGrath will be leading this inning off after making another great defensive play, helping out his first baseman battle in the sun.
And of course, he was one of the many hit batters in that fifth inning that brought so many around to score.
And the 1 pitch is a curveball right down the middle for strike number two. It's going to be a strikeout for Danny Wilkinson, getting McGrath swinging.
The first baseman.
First sign of confidence from the relief pitchers of Villanova. Andy Bennett now coming in, who had that sack fly earlier in the game, in the last inning.
That's going to be strike number one to Andy Bennett.
That sack fly was his 12th RBI on the season.
A little efficiency by Danny Wilkinson, as that's five straight strikes. 3 to McGrath, and now he has Andy Bennett down in the count 0-2 as the 0-2 pitch. And this is a little bit low and outside.
Yeah, it just looked like he held on to it for a little too long. Just moved it off its original path.
And the 1-2 to Bennett. Swung on and missed, and that's strikeout number 2 for Wilkinson in the inning.
Wilkinson doing what no other Villanova reliever could, just dominating these Butler hitters.
And it is 3 straight strikeouts for Danny Wilkinson, dating back to last inning.
And a total of just about, what is it, 6 strikes in 1 ball?
Yep, as that one.
That one hit hard, but very high.
First pitch of the at-bat for A.J. Pointer popped up to the second baseman. He's squeezing in a very efficient inning
so
for Danny Wilkinson.
1-2-3 for the Dogs and 1-2-3 for Villanova.
Nobody left.
That fifth inning really took a lot out of both teams, it looks like.
Butler 11, Villanova 3.
That's going to do it for the sixth inning. The Bulldogs are leading the Wildcats 11-3. You're watching Butler Baseball and Butler Athletics YouTube Live.
I'm right on the Pacific Coast Highway. I could walk up the hill and walk down. I had a little bungalow.
That's an alley, right?
No, that's an institute. But before I came home this time, 2 years ago, I got home here. I was with them in Detroit. When we went to a fire station, I was hanging out on the beach.
Welcome back to Bulldog Park here on the campus of Butler University. 6 innings down and 3 to go. Butler leading 11-3 here. And Scott Wright is back for his second inning of work.
Yeah, the first time Scott Wright has put in more than one inning so far this season. Very efficient in his first inning of work, looking to continue that trend here.
As Villanova's best hitter, Ryan Torres, steps into the batter's box. And pitch number 1 is strike number 1.
A guy like Torres, always a threat at the plate, looking to paint corners here. Will be right.
That's strike 2 from
Does
Wright.
It successfully back-to-back.
Butler's done a great job at keeping Torres off the base pass with him heading into a double play and a strikeout. They did intentionally walk him one time, but wisely, I would say. As the 0-2 is popped up to the third baseman.
Flared up just off the inside of the bat. Couldn't get great contact on that one.
36, right field.
Right into the shift.
O'Reilly.
It's 3 pitches and 1 out there for Scott Wright, pretty efficient on the mound.
Well, 36 on 36 matchup here. Not too many other 36s in baseball. Can't have as much fun as we can with 2s, but.
Is Jack Riley batting for the 4th time today? Right ahead 0-1, and the 0-1 pitch catches that outside part of the plate for strike 2.
Scott Wright painting the black today, looking excellent in his work, very efficient. A nice change of pace from the first few innings.
The 0-2 pitch to O'Reilly misses high.
Steven's gonna Let's go, Jack!
That pitch fouled back by O'Reilly. Scott Wright looking to finish the batter here. One and two.
The 1-2 swung on, popped up to the first base side, and Bennett's going to have some room to make that play, and it's going to head off his mitt as he got a little worried by the wall.
Yeah, didn't lose it in the sun this time, but just off the end of his glove.
O'Reilly back in the batter's box. Wright winds and deals, and that pitch is going to be hit to McGrath at second. Flips it over to Bennett, first base for out number two.
Excellent defense by McGrath, charging in on that play, unable to make a real full throw, so just the sidearm toss there.
Second baseman
gets the runner at first.
It is five up and five down for Scott Wright and his relief of John McCauley. Hitting now for Villanova is Cameron Hassert. And first pitch from Wright, a little bit inside.
First time Scott Wright has gone down in a count.
Scott Wright working pretty quickly.
Paints the black on that outside pitch again.
He moves the count to 1-1. Two outs here in the top of the seventh inning. Moves ahead in the count there with getting O'Reilly swinging, or sorry, Hassert swinging.
Hassert 0 for 1 with a walk.
It's a second pitch by Wright that's almost hit Hassert. Moving the count to 2-2.
Scott Wright with two outs here, falling into some of the similar predicaments as McCauley did earlier.
And he gets him swinging. That's three up, three down for Scott Wright in consecutive innings of relief. And he's doing his job out there, getting outs and keeping Villanova off the board.
Scott Wright keeping the game moving right along. Looking great out there for the Dogs.
Yes, indeed. Butler is leading Villanova 11-3. We're moving to the seventh inning stretch. So go take a little stretch break if you're watching at home. It is that time of the game. You're watching Butler Baseball on Butler Athletics YouTube Live. Second half of the seventh inning here.
Your Bulldogs, center fielder.
Butler taking on Villanova here, leading 11-3. Danny Wilkinson back on the mound for Villanova. He's been nothing but efficient ever since coming on in relief. Maybe Butler struggles with the lefties as Tyler Arella and Danny Wilkinson, both lefties, and the two pitchers who they've struggled against.
Shoup coming up following his RBI hit by pitch in the fifth.
It's the center fielder, has been busy out in center field today.
Wilkinson coming in for another inning of work. Both relievers coming on strong. Villanova took a while to find the guy that was going to work, but Wilkinson has been putting hitters away pretty quick. Bulldogs got to look to extend their at-bats here and put some of the bat on the ball there.
Catcher Rayner wanted a strike there. Checked down for the third base umpire to make a call, but Shoup able to check his swing.
Great job of framing that one. Looked a bit outside, but the catcher able to snap his wrist back over and get that ball over the plate.
Count moves to 2-2. Wilkinson, it's 2-2, misses high. Count on Shoup moves to full.
Shoup doing a great job, able to stay calm in high pressure situations.
As the 3-2 is going to miss high. And it's going to be the first.
What you love to see from a freshman batter, getting some first team minutes, as they say in other sports.
And it's going to bring up the top of the order again. James Gargano for the fifth time today. Gargano is 1-for-4. With two RBIs in that big fifth inning that they put together. And that pitch is swung on, hit to the shortstop, McNary. 6-4, and they're unable to complete the double play there as the throw was a little bit off.
Excellent job by Gargano beating that out. Going to be a fielder's choice.
The designated hitter, 35, Aaron Steinhardt.
That's going to be the first out of the inning, and it's going to bring Aaron Steinhardt to the plate.
Steinhardt, who came up with a pretty big hit, a two-run single in his last at-bat, where we saw Gargano have that great slide in the home just under the tag of the catcher on a throw that looked like it beat him.
Gargano on first, and the first pitch to Steinhardt is called strike number one.
Gargano, the guy that we actually expected to be running today. Lots of other guys have been stealing bases as well. Maybe with one out here, we'll see him going as well. Pitcher looking him back, though.
Wilkinson's curveball misses outside.
Steinhardt, the sophomore, as previously mentioned, leading the team in home runs with 4.
That one's going to miss high on Aaron Steinhardt.
Though after Dan Harwood's home run in the fifth, he moves in to tie. Robbie McCarger, and Aaron Steinhardt with 4.
2-1 swung on. Healthy hack there by Steinhardt. Looking to take that home run lead back.
Yeah, love to see a little competition on the team.
Wilkinson's 2-2. Gargano goes, and he's going to be safe. The throw a little bit off, but I think Gargano definitely would have beaten that throw regardless.
Yeah, Gargano showing the wheels there. And then, like you said, a bit of a high throw by Will Reiner behind the plate for Villanova. But, yeah, I believe he would have been in there. So 4 now on the year for Gargano.
The count moves to full for Aaron Steinhardt. Another opportunity to get a run here. And that one's going to miss high. 2 on, 1 out here for Dan Harwin.
Yeah, Danny Wilkinson struggling a bit here in the inning. Started with three straight strikeouts, the last in the inning he was brought in for, and then the first two for last inning.
In Harwin's last at bat, he did hit a two-run home run.
First baseman who moved to right field. Already shown the power.
It's Dan Harwood looks ball one in there.
Butler 5-for-12 today with runners in scoring position. Harwood looking to increase that number.
Wilkinson looks back to runner to second. And that pitch has swung on and fouled down the left field line. One ball, one strike, one out here in the bottom of the seventh. Two guys on. Harwood at the plate. Wilkinson delivers, and that's one that's going to be called a strike.
Outside half of the plate there, as we've seen Scott Wright paint it nonstop out there elegantly, and Danny Wilkinson taking advantage of the same calls.
Wilkinson ahead in the count to Harwood. The 1-2 swung on and fouled off behind home plate. Harwood putting on a pretty good at-bat up there. Only has one hit today, but it was that home run that flew out the deep right. And that curveball almost hits Harwood.
Yeah, losing control out there just a little bit is Wilkinson. Yeah, he's missed on that curveball a few times. Unable to place it just where he wants it.
Count 2-2. Danny Wilkinson delivers, and that one's fouled off. Has to be four or five foul balls hit by Dan Harwood right here.
Yeah, I mean, throwing it back to Dan Harwood's last at bat. I don't know how many pitches he fouled off, but he had quite a lengthy at bat and was able to crank one out over the fence. So maybe these foul balls are a good luck charm for our guy Dan Harwood.
And that curveball is going to freeze Harwood for out number two.
The Bulldog catcher.
Unfortunately, his third K looking.
This is going to bring up the catcher, Duncan Hewitt. He has only one official at bat, but has been on base four times.
Yeah, the double in the second. He was our first run, and then he's walked, and been hit by a pitch. So looking to go 2-for-2. That pitch looked pretty sweet out there.
Himself alone has as many runs as Villanova does.
Yeah, when you push across 8 in one inning, you tend to get stats like that. Great pitch on the inside. Paint black on both ends.
Yeah, Wilkinson up on the count 0-2. Two outs here, two on. Bottom seven, Butler leads by 8.
With two outs, though, Butler 5-for-12.
And the 0-2 swung on and missed, and that's going to end the inning. Wilkinson did a nice job surrendering two hits, or two runners at least, and then getting out of it without giving up any runs.
Yeah, able to escape the damage.
That's going to do it for the seventh inning here. We've got two to go here at Bulldog Park. Butler is leading Villanova 11-3. You're watching Butler Baseball on Butler Athletics YouTube Live. Because I'm happy, I'm a body, you feel.
defensive substitution for the Bulldogs, taking over in right field, 13, Nick Ortega.
And we are back here for the eighth inning at Bulldog Park. Butler leading Villanova in the third game of this three-game set, 11-3.
Leading off the top of the eighth inning.
After a big inning that the Bulldogs had back in the fifth, putting eight on the board to take their eight-run lead.
That's both teams coasting since then. No runs being put up on the board. Butler had a scoring chance, but the pitcher, Danny Wilkinson, was able to keep them off the board.
Scott Wright in his third inning of work here as the first pitch is fouled up. And that one's going to bounce off the mitt of Andy Bennett. It looks like the first baseman of Butler today are struggling with that sun.
Yeah, for both people who have played first base, Andy Bennett, and of course, starting the day was Dan Harwood. Both have trouble losing balls in the sun. On earlier plays, Brody McGrath was able to come over and make the plays. There, it looked like he had it and just popped out at the last minute.
Shortstop Danny McNary, or Dylan McNary, has gotten an extra life up there. Scott Wright has been fantastic out of the bullpen.
Now into his third inning of work.
The 1-1 misses high and inside, almost caught the shoulder of Dylan McNary. Scott Wright throwing from the stretch. And that one's hit off the glove of Freddie Maddox, and it's unable to make the catch. It was a hard hit ball by the shortstop, Dylan McNary, but it looks like McNary pulled a hamstring on his way to first.
Yeah, I mean, an unfortunate end to the play. It was a great reaction by the third baseman, Freddie Maddox, jumping to get that ball, quite likely saving an extra base hit, though unable to make the play at first. And not sure what's going on here.
Biggio.
Now running at first base for Villanova, 35, August Biggio.
Last name like that always makes you wonder where the connections are to Hall of Famer Craig Biggio and, of course, his son, Cavan.
Is Cavan a star on the Toronto Blue Jays as that first pitch popped up and is going to be caught by the shortstop? A.J. Pointer.
Left fielder.
Excellent play there with the left fielder Gargano crashing. All about backing up people defensively. I've seen plenty of errors today. Good to see the defense staying active, even if they're not the ones who get the ball hit right at them.
One out here. Scott Wright working on the mound. Strike one. Batting is the freshman A.J. Hansen. struggled a little bit early in the day out in left field, but not much hit out there since. As the 0-1 swung on and missed. Scott Wright, fantastic on the mound so far. I mean,
yeah, Scott Wright really pounding the zone and showing he's got some swing and miss stuff in him as well.
I mean, minus the hard hit ball from Dylan McNary. I mean, that could have been caught by the third baseman, Freddie Maddox, or the pop-up caught by the first baseman. He's done a fantastic job out there as that one's golfed up. And it's going to be caught by the shortstop Pointer for out number two.
Two quick outs here, both the shortstop Pointer. Looks like we got a pinch hitter coming in for the Wildcats.
That's going to be number 11, John Woolley.
Now batting for Villanova, number 11, John Woolley.
Two outs here, top of the eighth inning, runner on. Pinch runner, Biggio.
Hooley, who came into the weekend batting just 0.91, has not had the best go of it up till this point.
The 0-1 to Hooley, misses inside.
Yeah, it was a good looking pitch by Scott Wright, but just off the inside half of the plate.
And that one's going to catch the lower part of the plate for strike number two. Scott Wright has been fantastic today out of the bullpen.
He sure has. This being the first time that he's worked more than one inning, he's looked phenomenal for the Dogs out of the pen.
And that's going to get him. It's going to freeze Hooley for strike number three.
He keeps up the great pitching. Great job out there by Scott Wright.
Bulldog fans,
that's great. Great work by Scott Wright. Stranding one on the base for Villanova.
The official online shop.
And that's going to do it for the top of the eighth inning. Butler leading 11-3. You're watching Butler Baseball on Butler Athletics YouTube Live.
That's ButlerBulldogGear.com. Defensive changes for the Wildcats. Now playing catcher number 11, John Hooley. At second base, number one, AJ Hansen. The new left fielder is number three, Sam Margulis. And now playing shortstop, 22, Cameron Hassard.
Welcome back to the bottom of the eighth inning here at Bulldog Park. Winding down here, Butler leading 11-3 here. Pretty commanding lead after that eight-run fifth inning.
Yeah, that has really been a turning point in the game. Though, obviously, given the Dogs the big lead, and they've been able to keep Villanova off the base paths, but also a turning point for Butler's offense, having not produced a single run since the inning.
And this is going to be Danny Wilkins' fourth inning. Butler really hasn't been able to figure him out that well. But it doesn't matter after that big inning that they were able to capitalize with the two other pitchers.
Yeah, the argument is there, you know, save the runs. If you're going to score eight in the fifth, you know, I mean, save the rest for the next game.
Freddie Matos, a third baseman, is in the box right now. And Wilkinson's 2-1 is swung on and missed. Count moves to 2-2 as Wilkinson gets him looking. It's been not a ton of strikeouts today, but most of the strikeouts have been players looking at the last strike.
Yeah, lots of not many, like you said, not many swing and misses, but a lot of guys who, and maybe this is a testament to a shaky strike zone from the umpire. Lots of outside pitches that, and catchers being able to frame them really well. Hard to maintain a strike zone for a batter if it's changing for the umpire as well.
First pitch swung on by McGrath to the third baseman. And over to first for out number two. And that's going to bring on a pinch hitter, number 42, Keenan Taylor.
Pinch hitting for the Bulldogs, 42, Keenan Taylor.
Butler with the big lead, looking to get some of their younger players involved. Keenan, a freshman. Steinhardt, a sophomore.
And that first pitch from Taylor is swung on out to right field. And it's going to be caught by the right fielder to end the inning, and that's a 1-2-3 inning by Danny Wilkinson, who's been pretty great out of the bullpen for Villanova, but Butler still leads 11-3.
Danny Wilkinson, exactly what Villanova wanted out of the bullpen, but would have preferred it a little bit sooner.
And that's going to take us to the last inning here. Butler up 8, looking for 3 more outs to end this game. And it looks like we have a new pitcher coming in to finish this one off. You're watching Butler Baseball on Butler Athletics YouTube Live.
Pitching change for the Bulldogs, taking over on the hill, 25, Derek Dries. Other defensive changes, now playing first base, number 40, Lucas Galdoni. And the new left fielder, number 12, Jacob Margroff.
Yeah, the whole thing was seen to brief. I just love to see it.
Welcome back, and it's the ninth inning here at Bulldog Park. Bulldogs with the commanding lead over the Wildcats, 11-3.
Chris Rotondo.
New pitcher on the mound is Derek Dries. Dries coming in with a 10.3 ERA, looking to lower that.
Certainly has a good chance to do it here with a pretty big lead, and Villanova batters who have not been putting any meat on the ball since they scored their last run in the fourth inning.
That first pitch a little low, but called strike.
New pitcher and a whole slew of changes as well. Galdoni taking over at first. Ortega was returning to right field. Margroff now in left.
Rotondo fouled off that 0-1 pitch off the tennis bubble. And ever since that big Butler inning where they strung eight runs together, it's kind of seemed like Butler's been in command of this game.
Just about ever since.
And that's going to freeze up Chris Rotondo for a first strikeout for Derek Dries of the game.
44, the third baseman, Nick LaRusso.
As this game winds down here, two outs to go, I gotta say it's really been it's been almost three different games that we've been watching. Started off, both pitchers giving up runs early. It was a very close game, tied 3-3. Butler would take a lead, Villanova catches up, and Butler would do it again, and Villanova would catch up yet again. And then there was the fifth inning, which seemed like a game within itself. Just nonstop Bulldog production. And maybe we think that it was going to carry on. And ever since then, we're in our third game. We have, two pitchers, Scott Wright and Danny Wilkinson, who have been absolutely dominant on the mound, putting up zero after zero.
Yes, it really has been a tale of three different games. At least part of the games, as the 1-2 is swung on out into the gap between center and right field, but the all reliable center fielder John Shoup, busy all day, makes a running catch.
John Shoup has a lot of catches in center field, and he comes over to right center just to make this one.
21, Ryan Coors.
Out number two.
There. Lots of distance covered there.
Villanova down to their last out of the game. Ryan Coors is going to be that guy that Derek Dries is tasked with facing.
And if any guy could keep a game alive for his team, it's going to be Ryan Coors.
First pitch to Coors, high and outside.
Yeah, leading his team in average, even having gone 0 for 3 today, still batting .346. He has been on some kind of tear, but today the Bulldogs have been able to keep him pretty quiet. Double play, a walk, strikeout, and a pop out. So looking to keep him off the base paths and on this side of the fence.
Dries down 3-0 in the count. Might have to see another batter unless he can work back and get Coors. It's a 3-out called strike. Step one to fighting back, and a 3-out count is to get one strike.
Good old strike one.
The 3-1 outside, and Coors will be on base.
Derek Dries, a junior, making his first appearance on,
36.
Excuse me, my bad. He's had five innings pitched before today's game. Given up five earned, 9 Ks, 6 walks. So not the most successful outings previously. But here with 2 outs, he's looking to shut it down here for the Dogs.
The 0-0. To Jack O'Reilly, misses low and outside. Dries really needs to not even focus on Coors over at first base, considering his run means absolutely nothing in this game. So, right as of right now.
Right. Even if he does move up and score, it really doesn't mean a whole lot in terms of the course of the game. So should be able to focus here on Jack O'Reilly.
Go, Jack! Derek Dries down the count 2-0. And the 2-0 pitch fouled on down the right field line. No Bulldog able to get over there to even make an attempt at catching that one.
Yeah, the first baseman ranging way over. That being number 40, Lucas Galdani.
The count on O'Reilly moves to 2-1. Coors on first, 2 outs here, top of the ninth inning. Bulldogs leading 11-3, looking for one more out to clinch this first Big East series win of the year and continue their hot streak against Villanova. As that pitch is swung on and missed by O'Reilly. The 2-2 swung on and missed. And that's going to do it. Bulldogs win.
Fantastic swing and miss there. Just got him to come around. Butler able to put a big, big score on the board in the fifth inning, tallying 8 runs, and that was the catalyst for the win today. No runs scored after that, but who needs it when you score 8 runs in an inning? End of the day there.
Yes, dominant pitching both by Butler and Villanova after that 8-run inning by the Bulldogs.
Scott Wright.
Yes, Scott Wright definitely had a nice job in the office today, throwing 3 scoreless innings.
Doing a great job in relief.
That's going to be Butler's first Big East Series win of the year, moving to 9-16, 4-7 in Big East play. And that's going to move Villanova to 3-10, or 13-10 on the season, moving to 1-8 in Big East play. Butler will be back in action next weekend as they go to UConn to face the Huskies.
Going to be a good matchup for Big East play.
So, Chuck, who's your player of the game today?
You know, I got to... As a dog, Coach Creighton. I don't know. It's hard to tell. There were a lot of great at bats. Great pitching by Scott Wright out of the bullpen. I don't know. I don't know who to give it to. Honestly, you know what? It goes to the catcher. Duncan Hewitt made outstanding defensive plays. He was the guy who scored the first run, got a lot of the offense going. As you said, he scored as many times just himself as Villanova did as an entire team. So I got to give it to him. And his defense saved a bunch of runs, you got to believe, when McCauley was missing the zone and throwing balls in the dirt nonstop.
There you have it, Duncan Hewitt, our player of the game today. You've been watching Butler or Villanova. Butler takes the series winning.
Fourth straight series win.
Yes, fourth straight series win against Villanova by winning game 3, 11-3, and taking the series. It's been fun today alongside me, Chuck Levine.
I wish I was Chuck Harris.
Chuck Levine. A great camera work by Nick Lewis. I am Anthony Cleva. So long.